Ginni Rometty, CEO IBM, said that cybercrime is the greatest threat to every company in the world. Per Forbes, cybersecurity job market is expected to grow to more than $170 billion in just 4 years. Cybersecurity spending to exceed $1 trillion. Unfilled cybersecurity jobs will reach 1.5 million by end of 2019. Cisco reports 6 million available cybersecurity jobs globally. Looking at the huge gap in skills for cybersecurity, Aegis launched Postgraduate Program, or PGP, in cybersecurity in association with IBM. PGP certification by IBM. Program taught by IBM cybersecurity experts and industry scholar gurus and top faculties. Launch your career in cybersecurity with Aegis School of Cybersecurity. Exposure to IBM Cybersecurity Lab and software. Add wings to your career and explore today about postgraduate program in cybersecurity in association with IBM at www.aegis.edu.in. Welcome to Aegis School of Data Science, the best school for postgraduate program in data science, business analytics, and big data in association with IBM. Industry association with IBM, AWS Educate, NVIDIA DLI, UbiTech. IBM has set up Business Analytics Lab. Final certification is issued by IBM. Aegis facilitates scholarships, financial aid, and study loans available. We will work on live projects from the industry. Curriculum designed with the help of top data scientists and companies. Hands-on exposure to machine learning, stats, deep learning, NLP, Google TensorFlow, Spark, IBM Watson, AWS ML, and many more. Highly satisfied students with amazing reviews. Program delivered by IBM experts and the best data scientists. Program follows globally acceptable North American credit structure. Proud alumni working as data scientists with leading organizations. Participants can get opportunities for internships and final job placement with leading organizations. Aegis organizes Aegis Graham Bell Awards, Aegis largest data science congress deep learning summit, meetups, and leadership speaker series. Network with the best data scientists and AI experts from around the world. Present your projects to the world. World-class delivery infrastructure and cloud learning management system. Three delivery models, full-time, executive weekend classroom, and online live interactive. Add wings to your career and explore today at www.aegis.edu.in. Ride the artificial intelligence wave with postgraduate program in applied AI, machine learning, and deep learning by Aegis School of Data Science in association with IBM. This intensive hands-on program develops the necessary and unique set of skills for launching your successful career in the fastest-growing fields of AI. The program curriculum covers in-depth artificial intelligence, Python, machine learning, natural language processing, cognitive computing, deep learning, Google TensorFlow, speech recognition, computer vision, and robotics. The program offers a wide range of electives, exposure to a wide range of technologies, tools, and software, work on live projects, program delivered by the best AI and data science faculties and IBM experts. After successful completion of the course, participants get postgraduate program, or PGP, certification from IBM. Different program modes, full-time, PGP and applied AI, weekend executive PGP and applied AI, and weekend online PGP and applied AI, world-class cloud learning management platform and mobile app.
Good afternoon, everybody. Hope all of you can really see me. My name is Bhupesh Daharia, and I am a CEO of Aegis School of Data Science, Cybersecurity, Business, and now we started blockchain as well. So I will be talking about today about AI, data science, business analytics, machine learning, and then that is the first meetup. So this meetup will be from now to till 3:30, roughly around 90 minutes I will be discussing about data science, AI, machine learning. And from 3:30 we'll be having another meetup on blockchain, and 3:30 to 4:30, and 4 o'clock to 4:30 we'll be having a meetup for half an hour about cyber security, and from 4:30 to 5 o'clock we'll be having a meetup on full stack development. I'm excited to see all of you over here, and feel free to use this chat box to really have a conversation with me. Yeah, so can we, Aditya, can you switch on the PPT? Okay, so let's start with the first meetup on demystifying about AI, data science. So all of you must be hearing a lot about AI, machine learning, deep learning, business analytics, and all those kind of stuff, and you must be hearing a lot of talk about the data scientist, the sexiest job of this century, and everywhere AI engineers are needed. So I will be trying to really demystify what all these terms are, what it means to you, for your career, what it means to industries, where it is being used, and how we can really upgrade our skills, how we can really launch our career. So this is what my agenda. So I will be talking about who we are, what are the opportunities in data science, AI, machine learning, deep learning. We'll talk about how this all started. So I will take you back into the history, where all this thing has started. We'll talk about, before I start giving you definition about what is AI, what is machine learning, deep learning, I'll try to really give you some product demonstration which we build over here, a couple of recommender systems, learners analytics, and all those stuff. Then we'll talk about invasion of future into present. Then I will give you bird's eye view about AI, and then I will try to really explain you what is machine learning, so you'll understand what machine learning from 20,000 feet view, and you can really have a conversation, intelligent conversation with anybody, what this machine learning is all about and what kind of business problem it can really solve. It will also talk about what is there in it for you as a software developer, what is it there for you as a business manager or marketing guy or operations guy, how you can really use all these tools. Then we'll talk about what is data science, then we'll talk about what are the difference between data science, business analytics, and then we'll see what are the skills and tools you will require to really launch your career into this area. And in between, if you have any questions, feel free to really ask me on this chat, right? There are a lot of questions. I can really see what is the difference between big data, analytics, business analytics. Rishi, I will be coming down to all those points step by step. please hold down. I'll try to really build up all these things right from basics. This is like a basic meetup. This is not an advanced meetup wherein I will be really covering everything from A to Z. Okay, so this is very brief about us. So I represent Aegis School of Business, Telecommunication, Data Science, Cybersecurity, and now blockchain. This institution we established in 2002. This is one of the rare incidents in India wherein industry and academia collaborated together and started this school. One of the very successful example is with IIT Delhi and Bharti. So Bharti and IIT Delhi started Bharti School of Telecommunication Management. And the same year we also started Aegis School of Telecommunication in collaboration with Bharti. And we used to offer the master's program in telecommunication management, quite successful program. And as we saw the success of this program, and subsequently in 2015, we joined hands with IBM, the global leader in cognitive, cloud, big data and software for launching our postgraduate program in data science, business analytics and big data. We were the first one, first institution in this country to start a PG program in data science. And today we have one of the largest alumni working with all top companies. We also started subsequently a school of cyber security and we rolled out our PGP in cyber security program. We also have a partnership with National Skill Development Corporation. We are official partner with GMAT and GRE for accepting GMAT scores and GRE scores. We organize Asia's largest innovation award in telecom, internet, media, edutainment, known as Bell Award. And then we also organize Asia's largest conference for data science congress. Subsequently, you can really find. That's very brief about us. we are proud to say that we have a collaboration with these four leading companies, IBM, of course, I told you about that. And then we have collaboration with NVIDIA. NVIDIA is a leader into deep learning. So when you really search for, when you upload any image on Facebook and Mark Zuckerberg is able to really tag you, whether you're Ramlal or a Shyamlal or you're John. So those kind of applications are powered by NVIDIA's GPUs, which earlier you used to play for games. Now, Ayubi is a leading company, valuation $5 billion. Based in China. This is a leading company for robotics. We partnered with them to impart you some advanced skills on robotics. And now we have Lynx and you can actually impart Alexa skills to Lynx to really do a lot of amazing work. We also partnered with AWS Educate, which is a wing of Amazon. And AWS Educate gives you access to the cloud platform. So wherein not only you can really deploy machine learning models, you can really do a lot of stuff. Now we have also launched a full stack program, so you can really use those course materials, cloud bench, you can really use a lot of good resources free of cost to build beautiful products. We are the only institution, in fact, in Asia Pac region, which is having collaboration with these four giants. We have been recognized for our contribution in building up our data science skills in this country by IBM. This is a program which I was talking about. We rolled out India's first postgraduate program in data science, business analytics and big data in 2015. We were the first program in this country, we can proudly say. This is the certification, since this is a joint certification with IBM, you get a certification by IBM and Aegis. Ritin Joshi will be giving an info session about more deeper into this program. We will be having the admission interviews on Mumbai on 2nd June, Delhi on 9th June, Bangalore on 16th June and Kolkata 23rd June for admission session of this July-August session for data science, for cyber security, for blockchain, for PGP in full stack program and PGP in applied AI. So these are the five programs which we are offering and you guys don't have to really now travel all the way to Mumbai. You can appear in interviews in these locations. The second program, which is postgraduate program in cybersecurity, we offer. This program is again in collaboration with IBM. I will talk more about this program in my last session. But briefly, this program caters to almost all 360 degree aspects of cybersecurity, right from cloud security to database security to application security to IoT security to blockchain security. This also takes care about network security and then of course penetration testing and ethical hacking. But unfortunately, people think that cybersecurity is all about ethical hacking or pen testing. And plus, we have also included machine learning and Python, plus IBM's very strong tool, which is called QRadar, which is being used even by government of Singapore and large organizations around the world. So this program is jointly delivered by Aegis experts and IBM cybersecurity experts. This program last year we rolled out in Bangalore, but now this is available full time in Pune, Bangalore and Bombay, all three centers at the same time, weekend programs as well. This is the joint certification you get from IBM. This is another program we rolled out, which is postgraduate program in applied AI, machine learning, deep learning in association with IBM. This is again joint certification you can really get. You can check on the website. This is additional certification which you get from for deep learning by NVIDIA DLI. This is a new program we launch this year, and this program is going to roll out in July. This program named is postgraduate program in full stack development in association with IBM. Another new program we have rolled out, which is a blockchain in association with IBM. So this is very brief about Aegis. Now let's come down to data science, AI, and what is the scope in this area. So I have listed down a couple of research. So Nasscom report says, which this report they publish in 26 July, this 2018, that around 1.5 lakh jobs are vacant in the area of AI, big data, analytics, data science in this country. There is another report by Hindu, which says that 2 lakh data scientist shortage is there in this country. IDC, a very prominent organization, IDC says that 80% of all the applications will have AI component by 2022. What it means that every software which you have built, whether it is a mobile app or a web app or anything, all these applications need to have some degree of intelligence. And from where this intelligence will come? Inherently from AI, machine learning, NLP, data science, these capabilities. So if you see YouTube, which is essentially a software, web software, but it is a smart software. So if you start searching for Rihanna songs, it starts showing you the Rihanna song. So it really, it is a smart, it actually understands what you really like, what you don't like. You go on Amazon, you search for a white shirt, it does not give you a recommendation for the pink shirt. So essentially these are the software tools, but these softwares has become intelligent. These are smart softwares, and that is what IDC says, that all these software will have some or other component of AI. So not necessarily that you have to really become a data scientist, but even if you are doing a software job, traditional software developer's job, you need to acquire these kind of skills to really be relevant in the market. There is another research which says by McKinsey that 1.5 million data scientists are needed. This is an old research, but still it's quite relevant. Let's see the landscape in India. This survey was done by FICCI, Nasscom and EY, and this joint report was published last year. What this report says, the India's population is roughly around 1.3 billion, which is like 130 crores. Out of 130 crores, 37% people will be doing a new job roles. So out of this 130 crores, there are roughly around 60 crore people working in India. So out of the 60 crore people, those who are working in India, 37% people will be doing a different kind of job role, right? And 9% of these job roles, what they are doing, will be non-existent by 2022. What it means, let's take a rough estimation, like for example, 60 crores, let's round off this 9% to 10%. So 10% of 60 crore is 6 crores. 6 crore people in this country will not do the same job what they are doing today. Their job will no more exist in next 3 years' time. And you don't have to wait for 2022, and this is happening now. If you see, data scientist job was non-existent job 5 years back in this country. You didn't have an Alexa skill developer in this country. There were so many jobs which were not there. You have very few jobs of natural language engineer. You have very few jobs of computer vision engineer. So all these jobs, new jobs have come up. Full stack developer. Full stack developer, the job was not there 10 years back. blockchain developer, this job was non-existent, say, maybe a last decade, right? So all these new jobs are coming. So anyway, this new wave is coming, and we need to really acquire new skills to really survive ourselves in this future and even today. Okay, so before I take a deep dive and try to really explain you what is AI, what is data science, what is machine learning, let me give you some examples of real life projects which we have built, which perhaps can really tell you what data science is capable of. So let me ask you a simple question, and most of you, you can really actually answer and type on this chat. All of you, you are attending this session. Any idea how many jobs are there in data science in this country? How many jobs are there in Python? How many jobs are there in machine learning or in cybersecurity or in PHP? Any idea, any of those folks? But perhaps you don't know, right? Perhaps you only keep on reading on newspapers what kind of jobs are there. And this situation is there, your university vice chancellor does not know, the college directors don't know, your parents don't know, you don't know how many jobs are there. We just flow with the hype and without any realistic numbers. And this problem is not only in India, this problem is worldwide. So we thought how to really solve this problem. And in fact, this idea, we got it from UNDP, which is United Nations division, and they advise government of India in terms of what kind of skills government need to really impart or invest money to impart so that people can really get the job. But they were investing the money without any insight. So we did this project, and this project is called finding the trends in the jobs, that what kind of skills are needed for the jobs and how many jobs are there. Aditya, can you really switch to the web? Okay, so this is like a student dashboard, and let me take you to the placement section. So I'm showing you the live dashboard. So here, if you go in this job, you can actually see that how many jobs are there. So if you see this cluster, so there are 26,000 jobs are there in this cluster of data science, machine learning, artificial intelligence, big data, analytics, right? And if you see, if you see, the biggest pie is a Python, and over here you can, if I click on the Python, you can actually see how many jobs are there in Python exactly. There are 19,000 jobs are there in Python. So when you really study, you feel motivated that while I am studying Python, it is not irrelevant skill, there are so many number of jobs are there. This project was done by our students and our faculty members, and this is available now open on our MUNI platform. Anybody can really go and check. And when you join Aegis, you also get this platform dashboard. Inside your dashboard, you can actually see. Let us see which is the second most important skill, which is SQL. And in SQL, you can really actually see how many jobs are there in SQL. There are 12,000 jobs are there in SQL within the job framework of, say, AI, data science, and all those areas. And you can also see which all locations these jobs are needed, whether in Kolkata or Chennai or Hyderabad and Bangalore. And we can really see clearly Bangalore is the having maximum number of jobs. All of you will be interested to know even machine learning. Let us check how many jobs are there in machine learning. This will show you how many jobs are there in machine learning. And at the same time, this will also show you this machine learning skill. There are 5,900 jobs are there in machine learning area. This will also show you this machine learning skill is needed in what all jobs. So it is needed in data scientists, it is needed in a software engineer, it is needed in AI and ML developer. It is needed software developer, data engineer, Python developer, ML engineer. So this machine learning job is not only important in as a data scientist, but it is also important as a software engineer. Let me show you another stuff. This is a job recommender system. So this job recommender system actually gives you the job recommendations based on your skills, based on your grades, based on the courses you have enrolled, based on your interests. And this is a personalized job recommendation system which gives you personal recommendation for each individual student separately. Now, all these things, they are the product of machine learning, they are the product of outcome of data science, because all these products are inherently fetching the data, working on the data, and they are smart like a human being. They are giving you some kind of insight. Let me show you another very interesting project. Can we switch into PPT? So likewise, we have done a lot of other projects. We have worked on this project which is very close to my heart. This is called Khojo. Now what this project does, we build a mobile app. So in India, there are almost close to 100,000 kids goes missing every year. And let me show you this mobile app. Right, so all of you guys can really see this mobile app. So this is a mobile app. We launched this project into Goa. We gave this project to government of Goa as a free of cost. So we also have a center for data science for social good, wherein we take up problems which are in nature for social good or governance. And this project is about finding the missing children or stopping women trafficking or child trafficking in this country, which is a major issue. What it does is a simple application. If you find any child wandering around, you simply take a photograph of that child and then you upload a photograph, and it fetches the geolocation, it puts into the cloud, and the rest is everything. Think simple. So if it finds that the children's photograph is already in the existing database, might be their parents have uploaded the photograph, and it find the Aadhaar card match, it finds the mobile match, it will send the alert of the current geolocation of children to the nearest police station. At the same time, it will also send an alert to the police station where from where the complaint was launched. It will send an alert to the parents, and it will send an alert to NGO. So somebody will really come and rescue the kid. So not only the technology is critical over here, but there are a lot of other angles, which is a legal aspect, which is like a participation of government and social bodies is very relevant to really make this project successful. We are inviting a lot of interns and research scholars, those who would like to collaborate with us on this project. And this project was developed by our faculty members and our student, and continuous research is going on this project. Likewise, we do a lot of other projects. Currently, we have built up a application which is facial recognition based attendance system. We are building up a model for employee performance improvement. This is purely HR people's analytics project, but it involves a lot of computer vision and a lot of analysis of traditional analytics. So these kind of interesting projects we are doing. We are building a chatbot which can actually help faculty members in terms of really becoming as a teaching aid. We have done some lot of work on learners analytics. This is called learners analytics. We have very few organizations around the world which actually has done this work, and most of our students actually get benefit of this learners analytics. This is learners analytics is about giving them the clear idea how they are performing, where they are. It tracks down their entire history about how much time they're spending on learning management portal, how many quizzes they have solved, what is their progress, and so on and so forth. We are taking it further. This also gives an idea that how you're likely to perform in a course of machine learning, whether you should really take deep learning as an elective or not. So based on all those historical data, it also gives you some degree of recommendation. So these are some very exciting projects which we are doing, right? Now let us come down to this aspect, that what is machine learning? What is AI? So you must be hearing a lot about AI. So when you really put this AI word in PPT, it becomes AI. But perhaps when you are writing a code in Python on R, that is basically machine learning or NLP, right? Or maybe computer vision. But on a serious note, AI is nothing new. AI is a quite old concept. When computers were evolving in mid 50s, late 50s, sorry, scientists thought, how about training machines to accomplish tasks which are simple for the human being, imparting some basic intelligent capabilities to the machine. And it took so many years for scientists to actually reach to the level where now machines can identify whether this is a cat or a dog, and machines now have started acquiring some degree of human intelligence. And when we really talk about human intelligence, it's a highly ill-defined concept, and still scientists are figuring out what intelligence is. But the simplest definition of human intelligence is that how a intelligent man behaves, right? So an intelligent man will not call this light changer as a snake. Intelligent man will be able to do 2 + 2 = 4, right? And these are the things which an intelligent man can really read. Whatever I have written on this PPT, all of you can really read this. So intelligent man demonstrate couple of behaviors and characteristics which leads to planning, which leads to learning capability. You can really reason. If I ask you, okay, jump from this 11th floor, you will not jump because you can reason. You know that you will die. Your ability to solve problems. If I tell you, okay, you have to reach Delhi in 6 hours, and you have multiple ways to really reach over there, you will be able to really figure it out how you can really do that. Knowledge perception, manipulation, social intelligence, creativity, these are the some characteristic behaviors which are linked to the intelligence. Let's see what is AI. So AI is basically more of a philosophy of making machines intelligent. When I say machines, I mean to say CPUs, right, computers. Making these computers intelligent. And also it is a combination of multiple technologies, right? And which are these technologies? Machine learning. Number one is machine learning. What is machine learning? I'll explain it further. But machine learning gives machines capability to learn. So how do you know that this is a black color? Because your mother has told you. How do you know that the background of this PPT is white? Because your mother has told you, because your teachers, your mothers have told you, and this is how you have learned that this is white and this is black. And similarly, if you have to really train machines to distinguish between white and black, or between cat and dog, you will give 100 images of cat and 100 images of dog, and that is how a machine will be able to really learn. And next image, if you show to the machine, machine will be able to really figure it out whether this is a cat or this is a dog with some certain degree of accuracy. So if you want to really impart some learning capability to machine, you do it through the machine learning. Next is natural language processing. You can all read this stuff, read this PPT. And if you want to impart this skills to machine, this intelligence to machine, this is possible through the natural language processing. Like for example, you want to really read tweets, that what are the people's sentiment after Mr. Modi has become our prime minister, right? What are the people's sentiment about Congress, right? Or how people are feeling about the Reliance Jio's 4G services. And if you want to really read about these things, you need to really read the text which people are doing on the blogs or Facebook or Twitter, all those kind of stuff, right? And when you have to really do sentiment analysis and all those stuff, you use natural language processing, right? Then if you want machines to really talk to you, just like Alexa or maybe like Sophia, you impart these intelligence through speech to text and text to speech technologies. And text to speech, speech to text is a subset of computer science. When you want machines to really look around, you impart these skills through the computer vision. So, for example, I have shown you this application called Khojo, and what this Khojo essentially does is taking the ability of human being to recognize whether this is a Ramlal or this is a Shyamlal. So, as a human being, you can really recognize whether this child is under distress or not, and who is this child, and you use your vision capability. And if you want these capabilities to be in machine, you impart these capabilities through computer vision, right? next is basically robotics. You want machines to dance like a human being, just like a Sophie or a Pepper. You impart these skills or intelligence through the robotics. So, in a nutshell, artificial intelligence is basically a combination of multiple technologies which are subset of computer science, and it is basically a goal, a object to make machines intelligent like a human being. So, AI was started in 50s, and then machine learning came in 80s, and in last 8 years deep learning has come. So, machine learning is a subset of AI and deep learning is a subset of machine learning. Essentially, machine learning and deep learning helps AI systems to give capability of learning. Let's take a deeper dive into what is machine learning. So, in next 5 minutes time, I will explain you what machine learning is so that you can really start talking like a pro, but I am giving you a 20,000 feet view of machine learning. So, machine learning is basically a subset of AI, and AI is a subset of computer science. And machine learning, essentially what it does, it uses historical data to really learn. Based on the historical data, machines can really learn and predict. Like, for example, you want to really predict whether there will be rain tomorrow or not. Okay, so you can actually use the historical data of last 20 years and can see if it rained yesterday or it rained tomorrow. If it rained like on 27th in Mumbai, perhaps you can really predict that yes, there is a 50 chance of rain and 50% of chance not, based on the historical data. For computer science guys, what it is, or those for the software developers, friendly definition, machine learning actually makes existing softwares smart, right? And how it does, let's take example of spam filter. So, traditionally software developers, they write a program, they write a code to execute something. Now, imagine that, and most of these softwares are basically rule based softwares. Now, imagine if you have to really build a rule based software to design a system to predict whether this is a spam or this is non-spam email. But it will be very difficult because you have to really keep on changing the rules every day, because you might develop a spam filter based on certain rule that the moment in subject line you see some keywords like a lottery or a money or some kind of stuff or free gift. These are the words typically spamsters use. But then spamsters can really catch up and they can really start using some different words, and hence you have to again change the rules and it is becomes very difficult. So, do you think that Google engineers, they every day they keep on rewriting the code for the spam filter? No, they don't do. And how this spam filter in Gmail works, that it learns from the experience. So, for example, you send an email to say 1 million people, and out of 1 million people, say maybe 100 people or 1,000 people realize that this email is a spam and they clicked on the spam, and based on this information, based on this knowledge, and which is essentially a data, the software, machine learning software, learns that yes, it identifies a pattern that yes, this kind of email which has got this kind of subject line or this kind of content might be a spam, right? So these spam filters, they continuously learn based on the new experience, based on the new example, based on the new data. So there are two definitions. One, machine learning helps software engineers to develop the smart softwares and not writing the rule-based software. These software essentially learns based on the data. Now, this is a new approach of developing a software, and which is becoming very popular. And the other one is identifying and doing the prediction based on the historical data. Let's go further deep into the machine learning. What kind of machine learnings are there, and what kind of problems we can really solve this with machine learning? So machine learning can help you, you can build infinite products with machine learning, but machine learning can help you to identify a couple of answers to business. For example, in business, you would like to really know how many customers are likely to buy OnePlus 7, which is a newly launched. Now, this you can really do based on the historical data of OnePlus 5, OnePlus 6, right? Or what is their historical sales and what are the sales of competitors. So you can really take multiple data points, and then you can really build up a model, right? You want to really predict what will be the stock price of say Google next Monday, what will be, how much rain Mumbai will be having this June, right? What will be India's population say in next 30 years. So anything which you would like to really predict, which has got some number component, you apply supervised learning, and in statistics it is called regression, right? And regression is there in statistics for last 200 years, which is recently borrowed in machine learning, which also tells how important statistics in machine learning, which we'll talk at subsequently. So one kind of problem wherein you have to really find some numbers, how much or how many you apply machine learning. The other kind of problems you can really solve using machine learning is whether this is a Shyam or this is Ram or this is Mohan or this is a Ramlal, whether this is a cat, this is a dog, or this is a donkey, whether this is a red shirt, this is a black shirt, this is a white shirt. If you have come across with these kind of problems, or whether you have a malaria or you have a viral, whether you have this cell is a malignant cell or this is a benign cell. So if you have to really identify these kind of problems, answers, whether this customer will buy or he will not buy. So these are called classification problems. And there are hundreds of classification algorithms which you can really use to answer these kind of questions. And machine learning is heavily used in this sense. The third kind of stuff is basically is called clustering. In clustering, what you do, like for example, you create clusters based on the similarity of the users or similarity between the data. Like for example, if I give you 350 million customers data of Airtel, and if I ask you that can you really create the multiple segments, and why do we really, in marketing it's called segment, why do we really create segments? So that you can target customers. You will not be sending one single promotional email to all 350 million customers. For example, Airtel launched a new service, tomorrow they launch 5G services. So they would not like to really promote this 5G services to all, say, 350 million customers. So they would like to, how do you really identify that which kind of customers you would like to really send this SMS or emailer or maybe call or those kind of stuff? That you typically do it based on the segmentation. So this clustering algorithm, they help you to really identify, create the groups based on their similarity and the closeness. Other important thing, machine learning can help you to identify whether this is a normal behavior or whether this is abnormal behavior, which is for anomaly detection. Let us take example, a bank. How does a bank identify that this credit card transaction is fraudulent or this is like a normal transaction? So, for example, you are using a credit card and you have been using only to really, you have been swiping for 1000 rupees and all of a sudden you swipe this credit card for 50,000 rupees. This is not a normal behavior. So, this machine, these algorithms, anomaly detection algorithm will be able to identify that this is a not a normal transaction, this is anomaly, this is abnormal transaction, and immediately they will stop your payment or they will give you a call that is it you who has done this credit card transaction? If yes, then they really pause this transaction. So this is primarily used for anomaly detection. The another kind of algorithms are there, which is typically reinforcement learning. In reinforcement learning, it is used primarily in robotics or games. So and it is used for autonomous vehicles. These are some links you can really go through and you can actually see amazing work of machine learning. There is a personality insight by this is hosted on IBM Bluemix. This is built on Watson. What it does essentially, so if you want to really identify anybody's personality based on the kind of word they are writing, maybe on Facebook or maybe on LinkedIn or some essay they have written. So you can really just cut and paste of that text and put it into this personality identifier, and this personality identifier will be able to really tell you what kind of this person is, whether he's introvert or extrovert. And that's not only sufficient, this will also tell you whether this person is going to buy a BMW or whether this person is going to really buy a bicycle, right? Who will be able to really influence? This is pretty scary that everything which you are posting on Facebook or LinkedIn or Twitter or anywhere, companies are able to really build a profile about your personality. And essentially for what? Essentially to really serve you the ad, that which product ad you will click and which products ad you will not click. What are the tools for machine learning? So there are multiple tools you can really use for machine learning. You can use R, Python. Python is like surpassed now R because Python is a general programming language. So you can use it for the machine learning, you can use for the software development as well. R is basically license to really get into any kind of job which has got a flavor of data science. Apache Mammoth and Spark MLab is used primarily for the large scale of data. If you want to really do the large scale of machine learning on large data, that is where you use Apache Mammoth and Spark MLab, both are free. Then Microsoft Azure and AWS ML, then prediction.io and IBM Watson platform. These are the platforms which give you only pre-trained models. At the same time, say for example, you have built, so I have shown you this recommender system, and this recommender system essentially has built on say Python. The entire model is built on the Python, and the site on which this recommender system is working is basically in PHP. Now you as a data scientist, you will not be having this high level of coding knowledge or software development knowledge to really consume those models into a live web app or a mobile app. And that's where these kind of platform, Microsoft Azure or AWS, comes handy, so that you can really take your model back into these cloud platforms, and these platforms can help you to generate the APIs, and you can actually call those APIs to see the magic of your model, machine learning model, data science work into real product. I'll touch very briefly about deep learning. Deep learning is a subset of machine learning, and Jeffrey Hinton is a godfather of deep learning, and he recently got Turing Award, which is like a Nobel Prize for Computer Science. Now, so deep learning became prominent in last couple of years, in last 7-8 years, and primarily because of 2-3 reasons. One, deep learning works on a large data set, so we have huge number of labeled data sets available. Second, deep learning algorithms need huge processing power, and now GPUs are available thanks to companies like Nvidia. So we have a large processing power, we have a cloud platforms, and we have a huge labeled data is available. At the same time, we have a better algorithms, and all these things has fueled the deep learning. And deep learning is very good for text or images or sound, these kind of applications, when you have the large data, and you don't have to really bother about the model explainability, and the accuracy level in deep learning is pretty good. In our project called Kojo, we are also using deep learning. We'll organize a separate meetup on deep learning, wherein you will go further deep into deep learning. Okay, so let's come down to data scientist. What is data scientist? You might have heard about this statement, data scientist is the job of 21st century, by Harvard Business Review. And this article was written by Dr. Patil, who is Indian origin guy. And this, he has written this article in 2012 in HBR, and that's how data scientist would become a vogue around the world. And let's take a step back, and I'll take you deep into the history, how this AI, data science, and all those things evolved. So all these internet companies, they were formed in mid 90s and late 90s. So be it Google was launched in 99, eBay was launched in 95. So most of these internet companies came in during this period. And early 2000, these companies started seeing the traction. And when Google launched, Google had no idea how they're going to really make money. And eventually they figured it out that by only doing the search, they cannot really make money. And when people are searching, they need to really serve the ad. And if they have to really serve the ad, right ad to the right audience, they need to really have the complete insight about the audience. Just like a Facebook. Facebook have complete understanding about who you are based on what you click, based on what kind of stuff you're sharing, based on the images you're uploading, based on the posts you're liking, based on the videos you're watching, everything, and all those data they have. Netflix knows everything about you, that what kind of movies you're liking, what kind of series you're not liking, all those data they have, and based on that they can really recommend you. So in late 90s and even early 2000, these companies figured it out that if they have to really give better customer experience, and they have to really monetize it well, and if they have to really serve the ad properly, they need to really have a huge insight about the customer. And that's where all these companies started saving the data, even the log data, irrelevant data, which generally companies used to discard. So whenever the log really surpasses a certain level, it becomes liability and you clean the log. But all these companies, they started storing those data so that they realize that this is a gold mine, and if they are able to really mine this gold mine, they can really become billionaires. And these companies started storing the data, but storage of the data is also problematic, and that's where a smart gentleman called duck cutting came into the picture. And duck cutting built a Hadoop system in 2006, which essentially gives you freedom to store the infinite amount of the data at very cheap cost. And what he did, he built the Hadoop system, which is flexible, that you can really store any kind of data, be it structured data, be it unstructured data, be it images, video, text, any kind of data. And this Hadoop was made free of cost. It was donated to Apache Foundation, and that led to the big data boom. And this also solved a major problem of storage of data cheaply, because earlier they used to save the data in servers, and servers is damn costly. Servers cost a lot. They are just like a gold brick. So these companies, they rely that they solve one problem, which is like a cheap storage of the data. It gave them the flexibility. Unlike RDBMS, you can't really dump everything in RDBMS. You have to really have the structure. In Hadoop, you can really store any kind of the data. It improved the processing power, right? So this solved one part of the piece, which is like storage of the data and fast processing of the data. Still another piece was remain unsolved was how do you really analyze this data fast so that you can really get the insight, and based on that you can really serve the ad. And you cannot really manually analyze the data and then give ads to the relevant customer. This is not scalable. And that's where this whole AI and machine learning started coming back from the universities. Earlier, all these machine learning AI research were done in university labs. And all of a sudden, these companies renewed the interest in AI and machine learning because they realized using AI and machine learning, they can build these automated systems of serving the relevant ad or doing the personalization. And also in 2008, this gentleman, Dr. DJ Patil, and his friend Jeff, both of these guys, so Jeff was working for Facebook and DJ Patil was working for LinkedIn, and both of these guys, they had the data analyst designation, but they were doing a lot of advanced level of data analytics, which was not the part of the traditional JD of data analyst. And what they were doing, essentially, a data analyst is supposed to analyze the structured data or business analyst, but these guys were analyzing a lot of unstructured data, because in LinkedIn you have a lot of text, Facebook you have a lot of text which you have to really analyze, a lot of log stuff, and they built some data products as well. So they realize that the work what they are doing is far beyond the traditional business analysts and data analysts, and that's where they thought that they need to really come up with a new designation. And one evening in one pub, both of these guys figured it out, this new title which is called data scientist. And not only they crowned this title on their head, and this whole data scientist word became actually vogue in Silicon Valley. And 2012, when DJ Patil wrote an article in HBR, the whole world jumped on this data scientist. I know most of the data scientists in this country and all known data scientists around the world, and we ourselves are teaching data science, and we have data science delivered a consulting practice. We take a lot of consulting assignments, commercial assignment in data science delivered. We ourselves do a lot of data science job. No, I don't find that there's any sexiness in this job. This is a messy job. This requires a lot of hard work. You have to clean data. You have to really build up models. You have to really test models. You have to deploy it. It's a messy job. So what is the sexiness in this job? The only one sexiness which I could really see is a lot of money. I'm not here to glorify the data scientist job. This money, of course, they make a lot of money, but this money comes with a lot of hard work which goes behind that. And becoming data scientist is not impossible, it's not easy, and it's not so difficult as well. But it requires a lot of effort, a lot of hard work. Now, typically in India, a data scientist with 5 years experience draws somewhere around 25 to close to 50 lakh rupees in India. A fresher guy typically makes somewhere around 8 lakhs to 15 lakhs. This is what the fresher salary, what we have seen at Aegis and what we have seen in the industry as well. You will not find data scientists with 15 or 20 years experience, but any guy who is having 10 years plus experience, there's roughly around make 1.5 to 1 crore rupees salary easily in India. I am not talking about the US market. data scientists, what is another sexiness in this data scientist? These data scientists, they are magicians. You don't have to really give them a problem, you just simply give them the data, and they themselves can figure it out what problems they can really formulate looking at the data. They can analyze the data, like for example, if I give you a 160 million customer data of Amazon, And if I give you enough time, you can really analyze the data and you can really figure it out, different opportunities, and you can figure it out certain problems, right? So data scientists, they have inquisitiveness, and they can really work under uncertainties. They can really formulate the problems. What is data science? Data science is about making the sense out of the data. So now, what is the big deal? So even when a dog crosses the street, he analyzes the data around him, right? He looks at the street, he looks at the traffic, right? And he analyzes the data. What is the big deal in this? The big deal is this data. Here the data is not a traditional data, structured data, which business managers or business analysts used to really handle. Still they are handling. So this data is a big data, and this data has got a lot of variety. So this is a messy data. This data is coming from multiple sources. Sources could be email, could be ERP systems. This data is structured, unstructured data, text file, emails, videos, music, right? And that really makes it tough to really analyze. And data scientists, they analyze this unstructured large volume of the data, wherein business analysts, they have been trained traditionally to analyze the structured data, which is a row column data, right? At the end of the day, both are trying to really do the same problem, solve same problem. Business analyst is also trying to really solve the problem, what will be sales of this product. At the same time, data scientist is also trying to really solve the problem that what will be the sales of, say, 1 plus 7. But business analyst is trying to really solve this problem based on the structured data which is there in Excel sheet, which is historical data. So he can really see what was the sales, and based on that he can really predict. But data scientist will go further deep into this. He will take the structured data which is an Excel sheet, which is a sales record, but at the same time he will go and do the tweet analysis that what people are talking about, 1 plus 6 or 1 plus 5, so that he can really find if there is a grievance among the customer or there is some complaint about that. Will go and he will do the competitive analysis about the other products. He will also see that when they release the advertisement about 1 plus 6, what was the customer journey, how they actually gone over there on Amazon, and how they actually purchased that product. So did they spend more time on iPhone, or how? So they saw the ad, they went to 1 plus 7, plus they jumped to the iPhone, and they subsequently bought the iPhone. So they will try to really analyze all kind of data, which is log data, web analytics. They will try to really see the structured data. So all kind of data, whatever is possible, they will try to really see if it can really improve the accuracy level. And that's where data scientists, they are good over the business analysts. Data science is also about making the data products, which is automating the data science. To give you a simple example, this is a recommender system. So Snapdeal, there are almost 25 million customers, 5 million products. And how Snapdeal actually, so you go on Snapdeal, and when you search for a gray shirt over here, you don't find any pink shirt, right? And how Snapdeal is able to really do, they build this recommender system, and Amazon is a pioneer for that. So 1/3 of the revenue of Snapdeal or Amazon comes out of these recommender system. And what these recommender system essentially does, they based on your past purchases, based on your interest, based on your location, based on what search you are doing, they will be able to really recommend you just like a traditional shopkeeper. So if you go to a traditional shop and if you ask for a gray shirt, how a shopkeeper actually behaves? A shopkeeper says that, sir, you can buy this, you can buy this, you can buy that. And that's what essentially this recommender system is also doing. And this recommender system is built by data scientists, machine learning guys. This is a machine learning algorithm. Now, let's talk about what are the skills and competencies which are needed to become a data scientist. So, you have to have a domain knowledge. When I say domain knowledge, like for example, you want to predict whether you have a cancer or you don't, right? So, you need to really have some knowledge about, say, health, or you need to really have some domain knowledge about oncology, you need to really have some knowledge about cancer, right? Or say for example, you are trying to really solve some problem about say banking or finance industry, you need to really have some understanding about the banking and finance industry. But as a fresher, you don't have to really worry about that, because when you will engage into these data science projects, as a part of your team, you will have a domain expert, so those who will hold your hand and they will tell you a bit about the domain. And anyway, as a part of our program, we have a lot of electives on domain, which is like marketing analytics, financial analytics, retail analytics, right, supply chain. Those you can really pick up and you can really gain some knowledge about domain, which is a good starting point, but the real domain you actually get with the domain experts. The second most important thing, which is math, statistic, probability, I would like to call it math, because every analysis which you do, it's essentially a math, it's a mathematical analysis. So you need to be extremely good in mathematics, you need to really build the ability to think in math terms. And then machine learning. Machine learning and statistics is our backbone for data science. And machine learning actually adds wings to any statistical analysis. And the original name of machine learning is statistical learning. And then bunch of IT tools, which could include R, Python, Hadoop, Spark, Tableau, ClickSans, right, Hadoop, AWS, Azure, TensorFlow. So these tons of tools are there, which keeps on coming, which keeps on going. But by and large, if you want to really make your long-term career, you need to have very strong understanding about the math and machine learning and tools you can really acquire. And where it is applied, Akash Gupta says, I have knowledge on machine learning but not applied on a real-time project. Yes, Akash, you need to really, so how recruiters are currently hiring, they're not only just interviewing you based on the machine learning, but they are asking you to open your laptop and show the project. And that's what we have seen in all the campuses dealing with hundreds of companies and Aegis School of Data Science. And of course, they ask the fundamental questions on machine learning, what is ROC curve, or what is confusion matrix, or why are you using neural network, why not decision tree. But they will ask all these questions when they start looking at the project, because they want to really see, are you capable of demonstrating, applying your knowledge in real situation? So learning alone, machine learning is not sufficient. Vishnu Vardhan says, I have a knowledge on machine learning, but I am not keen on my ideas on real time problems where I can work out. Okay, so you can really go on Kaggle, you can really search for some startup companies which can really help you to really give some real life project. But there are tons of the project ideas. If you really go on Google, you can really find, or you can also apply for the internship at Aegis. We keep on hiring a lot of interns, and we give them a lot of real projects, real life projects on which you can really work. So you can happily apply to us. You can apply at career@aegis.edu.in. You guys can really note down career, Ritin, you can really put it in chat, career@aegis.edu.in. You can send your CV and you can apply for the internship. If you guys know about machine learning and Python, we can really help you to really give you some internship. Bullet Z, is it your real name? I would appreciate if you can write your real name, but your question is interesting. What is the difference between machine learning and data science? So, a very interesting question. Data science is machine learning is a subset of data science. Data science, machine learning is a data science technique. At the same time, machine learning is AI technique. Data science uses machine learning, one of the machine learning techniques, to do the prediction. But data science also uses other streams, which is like mathematics, statistics, probability, it uses visualization. right? So data science uses multiple tools to really solve problems based on the data. I have told about prediction on how much is the accuracy of the output. It depends on the model and depends on the data, right? But machine learning algorithms will never be able to really give you 100% accurate outcome. These are the probabilistic models which gives you the likelihood. So tomorrow if I have to really predict whether it will rain or not, it will not give you 100% accurate answer. It will say that yes, there is a certain likelihood, 70% likelihood that tomorrow it will rain or not. I have a good knowledge of programming language. If I want to go in machine learning, where to start? Very good question. So you need to really start learning mathematics, and then you need to really start some enrolling some course on machine learning, which you can really do it online or some on campus. The tons of material which is there out there on the internet, you can really actually do that. Do Aegis also provides weekend courses in Chennai? No, we don't have campus in Chennai, but from Chennai you can do the online courses. Anyway, coming back, data science and business analytics is used almost in every area, be it any industry, be it automobile industry, be it airline, be it telecom, be it healthcare, and be it any functional area, be it sales or marketing or finance or HR, operations, almost in every functional area, data science is used. Like, for example, you come across a problem in industry that you join an industry, your boss says, okay, we want to increase our sales. How do we really increase our sales? You can actually apply data science, right? And based on case to case, you can apply different use cases. Like, for example, if this is typically e-commerce company, you may like to build a recommender system to really do the cross sale, right, and improve your sales. So if you are in, say, HR department, and if your boss says, okay, we want to really find out what is the attrition, right, and who's likely to leave the company, this is a problem. So you can actually use data science, machine learning to actually solve this problem. So it is used almost in every department and every industry. Ritesh Gupta, I'm working as a business analyst in mortgage domain. I am not into data analysis, but into requirement gathering and documentation for software development. I have 6 years experience. I am based.
Can you switch to data science or not?
Yes, you can switch into data science, right? So anybody can switch in data science. So there is no prerequisite requirement to jump into the data science, whether you are from coding background, whether you are from business background, whether you are techie background, non-techie background, commerce background, computer science background, physics background, any background guys can really get into data science, as long as they have a curiosity to really solve problems, as long as they have mathematical thinking or appreciation for the mathematics, right? As long as they have an aptitude to learn coding, because coding is very critical in this. You need to really learn Python and R. It is not a software development program, but R and Python is essentially used to really analyze the data, just like Excel sheet, right? The only difference is that R and Python, these are the command line language, which psychologically gives you an uncomfortable feel, wherein Excel sheet actually gives you quite a comfortable stuff. But once you start using R and Python, you will see the magic, you will fall in love with these languages, you will see what kind of magic these languages can really bring in data analysis. So yes, you can actually jump into data science, and your domain understanding will be a plus for you. Sir, Ankur Anand, I am in commerce graduate. I have a deep interest in data learning and playing with numbers. So I will be shifting career towards, okay, yes, if you love numbers, this is the field, because this field is about all about numbers. So let's take example. Congress party hired, Congress is the first political party around the globe which hired head of the data analytics 2 years back, and Mr. Chakraborty, he is the head of data analytics division of Congress party. BJP does huge data analytics. So all these political parties, they have data analysts, those who analyze. So if they really do some kind of political campaign, if they do some kind of post on Facebook or YouTube, they also analyze what people are talking, what is the people's response. So everybody is using it. Government of India is using. So they are using to really identify the tax defaulters. And they launched 4 years back a project called iInsight, and based on that project they are able to really identify who are the tax defaulters, and that the reason income tax recovery is increasing in India, right? So it is applied almost every area. It is not only used for building up recommender systems or chatbots or applications like Ola or Uber, right? It is used in all sort of analysis. Kapil, is it late to start machine learning as I have 2 years of experience in ETL? I will switch. I can easily get around 8 lakh package. And are you saying a fresher will get 8 lakh package? Then what the difference? Okay, so I think you didn't get the point which I was trying to tell. Kapil, with 2 years experience, it is your choice. It is not only about money. So if your motivation is only money, then I would not recommend that you should really get into data science or for that matter any field. If you really love this field and anyway you are on the first step or two step in data science, you are already doing ETL. So you already having a data engineering idea, right? So it will be much easier for you to actually get into the data science. So what I was trying to really tell, at our campus what we have seen, salary ranging from 6.5 lakh rupees to up till 45 lakh rupees. This is a salary range. Yesterday we had a Japanese company which interviewed couple of candidates, right? And the kind of salaries they will be offering, these are the mind-boggling salaries, right? So you have to really see when a fresher guy can really get a 8 lakh rupees salary. And since you already have a 2 years experience, experienced guys, those who are having up to 7 years experience, they typically get a jump of minimum 50% up till we have seen roughly around 550% jump. That is what we have seen. Right, so if today if your salary is 6 lakh rupees, you can expect at least 100% jump, which is like a 12 lakh rupees. That is what you should hope. Don't try to really misread my word that is what we are trying to really claim or give you the guarantee. No, that's not what I am saying. What I am trying to really say that yes, there is a huge difference, and since you already have the ETL experience, you have a huge scope for you in this area because you understand the legacy system, right? And data science also involves data engineering, machine learning, right, visualization, almost all aspects, right, which you need to really learn. Anyway, moving forward, what is data science? What data science covers? Data science covers data integration, distributed architecture, automating machine learning, just like I told you, recommender system, data visualization. I gave you example initially about data visualization. The job and skill trend analysis, right? A beautiful visualization, which is a dynamic visualization. If I clicked on Python, you could really see how many jobs are there in Python. So dynamic visualization, dashboarding and BI, which is very critical. Data engineering, when I say data engineering is a foundation for any data science building block. And what data engineers, they do essentially, they build data infrastructure using say SQL, using say Hadoop, MongoDB. So their job is to really build the data infrastructure on which data can be really stored, processed, so that data scientists or business analysts can really analyze those data. In India, in US all these roles are separate, but in India in startup companies all these roles have merged. So today data scientists is also needed to really have some degree understanding about data engineering. Let me give you an example. 2 years back we took up one project with a company called Devoice, Ion Infotech, which is a leading internet service provider. They approached us and they wanted us to solve two problems, which is identifying the churn prediction. We took this project and we went to their company and we realized that they don't have the data infrastructure. So we built the data infrastructure on cloud using Hadoop and Spark, and we started collecting the data, and then after that we did the dashboarding, and after 6 months we did this churn prediction, which is essentially a machine learning project. Right. So since we knew almost all aspect, it was easier for us to really take up that project. So it is very critical skill. In North America, you have separate data engineer, separate machine learning guy, separate business analyst, separate data scientist. But in India, most of these startup companies, mid-sized companies have merged these roles. So it is good that you have understanding about most of the area. So in India, full stack data scientists are more popular, and that's what we are trying to really build at Aegis. This slide actually gives you a clear picture about the difference between data analyst, business analyst. So this guy first is data analyst, the middle guy is business analyst, and of course the iron man is data scientist. So data scientist, this is oversimplification. I didn't mean to really hurt the sentiments of business analysts and data analysts. Lot of business analysts, they are doing the job of data scientists as well. What did this picture say? The data scientists are able to do the job of business analysts and data analysts as well. I wrote a blog which says that how data business analysts and data analysts, they need to really upgrade their skill to really cope up with data scientists, or they will be wiped out. There is a question by Abhishek Sharma. I am from front end development background and I have around 5 years experience in the same, but I really want to switch my career in data analysis. Can I do, or I am already too late? No, you're not too late. We started data science program in 2015, and when I started, there was no institution in India which was running data science program here in India. In last 3 years, I have addressed almost roughly around 90,000 people in this country. So you are not late. You are at the right time, and since you already have the full stack development, front end development experience, this will really help you, because if you can really just go and search about TensorFlow.js, which is a front end technology which is basically to deploy a machine learning model on the browser, right? So today the world is moving, as I told you, data scientist has to become a full stack data scientist. So it's not sufficient that you build a machine learning model in a Python or a R, you need to actually deploy that machine learning model into a web app or a mobile app, and that's where your front end experience will really be handy to you, right? Hope this really answers. You can set up a separate call with me and I can really help you. You're not late. Ankur Anand, sir, what will be the requirement to get the education loan sanctioned from the course? Ritin will really help you. Ritin, you can really write your mobile number and you can really help him. So once you really get the admission in Aegis, any program, we have alliance with the banks. You don't have to really worry about the finances. Banks will give you the loan within a week's time. And if they don't give the loan, we have other alternates through which we can really organize your finances. If you have good academic records, I can personally assure you that you will get some financial aid from the Aegis. So money will never ever become a hindrance for you to study at Aegis. That's our commitment. So this is enough to, sir, I have experience in .NET and I have also done certification courses in data science, big data. So I'm not sure what certification you have done, but certification alone are not sufficient to get the job in data science. You need to demonstrate to the employer that yes, you can build some product, you can do the analysis. And this you can only demonstrate based on the work you have done. So if you have done say 6 to 7 or 8 portfolio projects or capstone project, then only you can convince the employer that yes, you have a demonstrated capability. I have interviewed one candidate last week in Hyderabad. I would not like to really name the institution, right? This candidate has done 6 months full-time course on data science business analytics, and this guy had a 2 years experience as a business analyst. But this 6 month course was such a poorly designed course. There was no practical experience and there was no in-depth theory which was taught to them. And eventually this guy could not really get a job, and this guy has enrolled for the program. I have seen several such a student. In all our programs, we are the largest institute for the data science full-time in this country. And we are 4 times bigger than IIT Kharagpur, IIM Kolkata and ISI in terms of the number. 90% of our students, they have done some or other courses on data science, machine learning, analytics online on Coursera, Udemy and multiple online courses, even short-term courses of 3 months and 6 months. Unfortunately, these courses are not very useful to those who do not have any idea about these areas. These courses are good for those who are already working in this area and they want to really upgrade their knowledge, or they have very high degree of motivation, self-motivation and discipline to complete those courses. Because majority of these students, they are not able to complete the courses, right? And just by merely knowing machine learning, nobody will give you the job or certification. No company cares a damn about the certification, right? Certification can really help you to really enter into the room, but you can crack interview only when you win the trust of the employer by showing, opening your laptop and showing the projects, right? Wonderful. So what skills you require to really become a data scientist? Number one skill is probability, statistics, mathematics, linear algebra. This is what you need to really know. That is the base. Right, Kapil, sir, my last question, as you said, ETL experience will also count in the field of data science. Yes, it will count. Machine learning is the second most important thing. Machine learning and statistics is the backbone of any data science program. And then natural language processing. Because you will not be only analyzing the structured data, you will be analyzing the text data. Then R. These are the top skills you need to really acquire to get into data science. Other skills is Spark. Spark can be used for data engineering, building up a data infrastructure. At the same time, Spark is used for analyzing the large scale of the data. So if you have a 40 GB data, you cannot analyze in R. You need to really have the Spark mlib. Spark mlib is a framework wherein you can really analyze a large volume of the data, right? So within machine learning, there is a different flavor. And then Python is growing exponentially, Hadoop. Then you need to really know deep learning, you need to know cognitive computing by IBM, not every company is asking, but it is growing. Computer vision, speech recognition. Computer vision has become now part of the data science. Of course, this is a separate field of computer science and AI, but it has got a huge influence in data science, because inherently, if you recall, I told you data science is about making the sense out of the data. And data could be anything. Data could be video, could be text, could be structured, could be unstructured. So computer vision helps you to really analyze the data which is based on the video and images. And then Watson Analytics, SPSS, still large organizations, yet they use SPSS, Cognos. machine learning using scikit-learn. So machine learning you have to really use on scikit-learn. Machine learning using Spark mlib for the large scale of the data. Then you need to really know the deep learning. Then you need to really know TensorFlow for deep learning, which is Google's TensorFlow launched 3 years back, right? So these are the multiple skill set you need to really acquire to really launch your career into, and visualization of course, because whatever the outcome comes, you need to really create dashboards. You should be able to communicate to the decision makers in beautiful graphs. And for visualization, you have ClickSense, marketing analytics, social media analytics. Then you need to really know couple of platforms like Microsoft Azure and AWS. Right, SQL is still very hot in this market because the world still works on the SQL. Any question, guys? So, Ankit, remote procedure automation RPA is also part of data science. Yes, this is one of the elective. So, we have one of the very wide range of elective. We have over 120 courses in data science. Right, so this course is a modular program which is a 45 credit unit minimum. It means that yes, you can really do roughly around 22 courses, but that is not the only limit. For example, you want to really do additional 5 courses, your credit structure will increase, say minimum is 45, you can increase it to 65 or 70, right? So each course is typically 1 credit unit to 3 credit unit. So we follow the North American credit structure. So you can take tons of electives. You can take electives in blockchain, you can take electives in TensorFlow.js, you can take electives in say cyber security, network security, because security, data science specialized in security are the highest paid guys in this country, right? So you can really take even those electives from the security side. you can take electives in RPA. So we have one of the widest range of the electives available with us in this area. Just check Saj. Okay, how do you enter into this area? Read this blog, datasciencegyan.com, and there are tons of other blogs where you can really go and read about this area. You can download these white papers. These white papers are pretty good white papers. Data science transforming ICT industry. You can take a snapshot of this page and Google it and you will get the white paper. You can get a white paper on opportunity in telecom arising from big data. This white paper is about big data, and data science white paper, which we jointly published along with Deloitte, is a fantastic white paper on data science. Another recently down white paper we published, which is on NLG, natural language generator, which is a subset of AI. This is NLG is one of the very fast growing technology around the world. You can download this white paper, and this will really give you some good idea. Pawan, it is good. May I expect any placement assistance from Aegis? Yes, we have one of the best placement. We do not use words like assistance or guarantee. We have one of the best placement. name any company, be it EY or Deloitte or KPMG or Atos or Nielsen, right, Indigene, all these companies they recruit from us. We have one of the largest alumni base in this country. You go to any company and you will find our alumni working extremely good job. You can really go on LinkedIn and search for our alumni. I would recommend that you go and get in touch with us alumni, talk to them, and have your clarity about what this field is all about. I am a mechanical engineer. Can I study data science? Fantastic. So I have two students. One mechanical engineer is working in a Ford, and you will wonder what the hell Ford is to do in data science. Ford has set up one of the largest AI team across the world, and they have the R&D center in Bangalore. One of my students is working with Mercedes-Benz, and mechanical engineers are very successful in this area, and not to say only mechanical engineer, anybody. In E-class, the girl who got the best employee award is our student. She is a BCom student. So whether last to last badge guy Abhishek, who got the highest package, he was a fresher, he was a BCom guy, right? So it doesn't matter from which background you're coming, whether you're coming from management, BCom, mechanical, civil, electrical, chemical, computer science. This is a misconception. This is the wrong notion that this field is only about say computer science guys. No, it is not. We teach everything right from the basics, so you don't have to get intimidated that you have to really learn in Python and R. Python is pretty simple language, you can learn in 15 days time, so you don't have to really worry about that. What is the fees structure? Ritin will tell you about the fees structure. Sir, I have 5 years experience gap into specifically software development. So it doesn't matter. So if you have a software development background, you already are comfortable with the coding languages, right? So you will be psychologically comfortable. So you'll be comfortable with R and Python and Hadoop and all those stuff, right? So you can really launch your career in this area. Yeah, Khushid, you can be successful in this area, provided you love numbers and you want to solve problems, right? Okay, thank you guys. Thank you so much. I can take one or two more questions. And then we can really wrap up this session, and we'll have now next session on blockchain. I am a German language expert working in finance domain. Wonderful. Germany is one of the area of country where IBM has set up the world's largest AI center, right? And one of my student is working in Germany in Vodafone as a data scientist, right? So you can actually leverage on your German language, not in data science, but of course to really get a job. But you have to really acquire your finance domain will really help you in data science. 56% of the revenue in data science analytics comes out of the banking and finance. And banks and financial industry is one of the largest recruiter, and that's where your domain knowledge will really come pretty handy. We have lot of students, those who have done MBA in finance, those who are MBAs, like roughly around 15% student, and they are very much liked by the banks because of their domain understanding. Should I do it that completely, I leave it to you. I have given information, enough information. And nobody to really advise you whether you should do it or not. I have told you what it takes, what skills it requires, what is there in this. So if you really feel that yes, you can really do it, you should go ahead. And you have the basic C language knowledge. I think you can explore this field. This is fastest growing field across the world. I have 11 years experience in multiple database and data science suitable for me. Yes, so you already working with databases, right? So you must have worked on SQL, right? And so you already on the one step of data science. So since you already have the experience of databases and that is the base of data science, the only thing what you're doing is not analyzing the data. Now in data science, what you will do, you will analyze the data and you will build the models to build the data product. So this is, I think this is a perfect field if you really like it. Yes, you can do a cyber security program certification in Pune. Yes, Jay. And I will be taking a session on cyber security at say 4:30 or 5 o'clock. Okay. Thank you guys. Thank you so much. And I love talking to you. and I really appreciate your patience and these questions. How much time I will take to complete this course? You will take roughly around 11 months to complete this course. Right. Okay, guys. Thank you. Thank you so much. Love talking to you. Now we have a session on blockchain. Savaj, please come.
Hello guys, so my name is Shabahat and I'll be taking a very small session on how blockchain is part of the exponential technologies which we are discussing today and what scopes do you have for the same, like as a job perspective or even otherwise. So my past experience, currently I'm working as a CTO at a company called Acex. It's a company based out of Malaysia. And we work on developing products using technologies like blockchain, AI, and IoT. But as of now, it is entirely dependent on blockchain. We'll obviously branch out into artificial intelligence and IoT later on. And my previous roles include, I was a blockchain architect for Oxysis. This is a company based in Mumbai itself, but they are ranked within the top 20 in the world in terms of blockchain infrastructure companies. And then there's a company called Kasha, which is Oxysis' sister company. They raised somewhere around 33 million in a crowd sale. We'll talk about the crowd sale in some time, like when we are discussing the use cases of the blockchain. And OxLedger is a blockchain infrastructure which is actually being launched out of India. It is also being done by the guys at Oxysis. And before I joined Acex, I was kind of the co-founder at OxLedger. And also I was the blockchain solution architect for blockchain labs in India. So basically, blockchain is what I've been doing for the past few years. So this is basically the portfolio of the entire work which I have done, which kind of covers what work there is in market, but then obviously there is a lot of other work which you can do. So with Acex, we are building a cryptocurrency exchange. So it's like a basic trade exchange, but where you can only trade cryptocurrencies. What are cryptocurrencies? We'll come to that in a bit. And we are also providing a portfolio management tool, which is obviously related to traders. So like that kind of couples with it. There's a crypto payment gateway, like in case you want to accept payments in Bitcoin or Ethereum or any other cryptocurrency, we are building that. And point of sale crypto machines, just like your credit card, debit card, POS machines, which you see at all those shops, or even whenever you go shopping, you swipe the cards on. So, and hardware wallets. Hardware wallets are something which are like kind of unhackable. Like if someone gets access of your hardware wallet, they won't be able to get your funds out of it. Unlike a credit card, say, where the person can obviously go and swipe it unless you have a PIN protecting it. With Oxysis, we had a lot of diverse work which kind of delved into non-cryptocurrency regions, which was not, and kind of a generic blockchain solution, which was what we were trying to provide. So we did this proof of concept with the government of Rajasthan, which was on the benefit distribution program. I'll come back to it when we're discussing the use cases. And then we had a blockchain solution for the healthcare sector as well, where we made a solution for clinical trial cycle, which is very complex. We'll discuss it later on. We had a decentralized peer-to-peer insurance protocol, which we built, and also an identity management tool on the blockchain. And as you can see, my previous work kind of reflected in my current work as well, crypto payment gateways. And Aux Ledger, as I said, it's a new blockchain infrastructure, which I worked on not a lot, but then we just started off with it. So now the question is, what is a blockchain? You guys must have heard a lot about it in the past few years. So just going by the definition, a blockchain is a growing list of records called blocks, which are linked using cryptography. Each block contains a cryptographic link of the previous block, a timestamp, and transaction data. So that becomes very technical, that line, but we'll break it down as we go ahead. It is open and a distributed ledger that can store transactions data between two or more parties in a verifiable and permanent way. So all of this kind of is hinting towards a specific direction, which is the financial domain, because as you can see, we are talking about transactions. So when blockchain came into existence, that is what it was aimed at, basically financial transactions, which was to be taken care of. But then it grew into something else, and it's still growing. It's in its evolutionary state right now. And it generally follows peer-to-peer protocol. And a blockchain generally has a consensus protocol, because peer-to-peer, there is no centralized authority which is taking care of all the rules. So every participant has equal power in that network. So you need to have a consensus protocol. So to give an example, you can consider democracy as a consensus protocol, where people come together and they vote and they choose their leader. And everyone accepts that, okay, whoever gets the maximum vote becomes your leader. People don't go around fighting about it, that why is that so? So a blockchain is something which will help you do the same democratic, achieve the same democratic status in case of financial institutions as well. We'll come to that, what it means. And as I said, every node participates in this process. They're equally, just like democracy, they're an equal member of the network, and they have equal say in which transaction gets included, is this transaction right or not, and so on. So as I said, it's a democratic alternative to the centralized trust-based systems currently present. So what are trust-based systems? We'll come to that. So as you can see, a ledger is nothing but where you're just writing down your accounts, who paid you how much money, or to whom you have paid how much money. So it has actually developed over time, like the ledger technologies, but more or less they have always remained centralized. They've never been decentralized as such. So any bank where you have your account, the bank maintains all the records. You are not able to access any other record other than your own. And for that also, you need a username, password to log into the net banking framework. So basically there's a single point from where you can access that data, and it is heavily regulated by the bank. And we trust the bank that they won't run away with our money because obviously that's what they're supposed to do. They're supposed to take care of your money. And so that's the trust-based model these guys are talking about, we are talking about. So basically there are multiple ledgers, but the bank holds the golden record. Client B must reconcile its own ledger against that of bank and must convince the bank of the true state of the bank ledger if discrepancies arise. So this is kind of a case where you remove your own historical data, say your bank history's data, and then you find some discrepancies, then you'll have to go to the bank and tell them, okay, this is wrong. And the bank has the final say in that, whether that's right or whether that's wrong. In case of a distributed ledger, as I said, every node, they participate in the process of what is right and what is wrong. So unlike a centralized ledger, the bank does not have complete control in case of a distributed ledger. So every node will be like, okay, this is a right transaction, this is a wrong transaction. But then there comes a point like people can form their own groups and they can kind of scam other people. So that's where the cryptography comes in. The cryptography kind of makes it very difficult for people to do that, even if they form groups together and try to like ruin everything for everyone else and gain a profit for their own, for themselves. So there is only one ledger and all nodes have some level of access to that ledger. So as I said, the bank only gives you your data, but in this case you have the data of everyone else. So the next question which arises is like, why would anyone else know what spending I'm doing? Cryptography comes to your rescue in that case as well. We'll come to that in some time. So all nodes agree to a protocol that determines the true state of the ledger at any point in time. The application of this protocol is sometimes called achieving consensus. So for any transaction to be valid or not, every node has to agree to the fact that it is valid. So this majority decision that, okay, this is a valid transaction, is the consensus protocol which I spoke of. So people who have done like database technologies, you might know, like you can basically shard your databases or like have replicated databases in case one of the databases goes down. So this single entity which we speak of, the bank, they obviously don't have just a single database running. They have different data centers where they have their own databases. So in a way they have a distributed database, but it is not publicly accessible to everyone. It's not open. So as you can see in the diagram, the single entity, it comes inside the entire bank infrastructure. It's not accessible to anyone outside. But in case of a blockchain, everyone has access to that database and they are kind of running that database on their own computers as well. So everyone is running the database, they have replicated the data on their own computers, and they're also verifying it at the same time and like sharing it with everyone else. So it's basically an open system where you don't have to hide things and there is no trust-based model here. Now the question arises, why will you trust say node B or node C? As I said, the cryptography is what makes sure that you can't fool anyone else. So the very first blockchain which came was Bitcoin, which is obviously the poster child of blockchain. So the first implementation, the software was launched in 2009. There was a white paper which came before that. We'll come to the white paper in some time. And it was meant to be a global currency and it spearheaded the first generation of blockchain. So basically they did not want any borders for your currency. Like, because there are borders, there are reserve banks, and those banks are kind of passing out the laws for your own country. And cross-border currency transfer becomes difficult because of that reason. Remittance, which is known as remittance, basically, that becomes difficult because of that reason. And doing any transaction across borders is a very big deal to do in today's world. You need a lot of regulatory stuff to fulfill for that. So Bitcoin came around and then a lot of people saw like how it was decentralized, how there was not a single entity kind of regulating everyone that you do this, you do that. Everyone participating in that network was equally responsible for the network. So a number of cryptocurrencies saw this and they were like, okay, we can also bring up our own currency. So what they did was they just copied the entire code of the Bitcoin and changed a few parameters which kind of define the cryptocurrency, and they launched their own coins. So there are a few examples like Litecoin, there's Namecoin, there's Dogecoin. And Dogecoin has a very funny thing about it was meant to be a meme. And then now today its value is around $1 or something. And the owner has a lot of money because of that. Current digital currency model relies heavily on trusting the reserve banks or the central banking institutions of a state. So generally there is no issue with that. But there are times when things go wrong. So an example, the very best example for this will be the 2008 economic meltdown, where the banks were like just giving out housing loans without any, like they were not being cautious about it, and that kind of made like generate a very huge housing bubble, which burst and the economy went into meltdown in 2008. And as you can see, the timing when Bitcoin was released, it was very like apt. It was in 2009, just right after this. And as you can see, the Times of India article, in the, that's not Times of India actually, that's Times. The very first transaction which has happened, there was this data attached to it, and the data was Chancellor on the brink of second bailout for banks. That was like they were kind of mocking the financial institutions that see what you have done. That's the very first transaction in the blockchain with that data along with it. And that kind of gave a timeline that, okay, this is when it started. Like people can be like, that started long back, you just changed the data or something like that, initially when it started off. So currently, as a global currency, USD is considered as the global currency because the United States has done a lot of work to make it so. But China is like obviously challenging that dominance, and there's a trade war which is going on. And Bitcoin is kind of meant to not have all those political implications involved, and but still have a global currency which does not have a huge machinery behind it which is making it work. So as I said, a white paper was published in 2008 in crypto forums and under the pseudonym of Satoshi Nakamoto. So this person's name is only known, the identity is not yet known. Someone just recently last week filed for a patent for the Bitcoin technology, but that guy is considered as a scam in the community. But somehow the he got a patent. Anyways, the true Satoshi Nakamoto is still unknown who that person is. And these, the next few lines are from the white paper itself, like how it starts and what the abstract is. So basically, commerce on the internet has come to rely almost exclusively on financial institutions serving as trusted third parties to process electronic payments. So the credit cards, debit cards, Visa and MasterCard, we like blindly trust them to do the transactions correctly. While the system works well enough for most transactions, it still suffers from the inherent weakness of trust-based model. So basically, at any point of time, the financial institution can bring up a very random law, like a very good example which happened in our country itself, for demonetization. They just brought it up and you had no say in it, because obviously it is a trust-based model and we trusted them that, okay, the old 500 rupees note are worthless now. We still trusted that in that case, which was true actually. So completely non-reversible transactions are not really possible since financial institutions cannot avoid mediating disputes. So if cross-bank loan transfers or cross-bank transfers occur, and sometimes there are some issues with that, like there's a very long process for it to get resolved. It's not instantaneous. And the cost of mediation increases transaction cost, as I said, limiting the minimum practical transaction size and cutting off the possibilities for small casual transactions. And there is a broader cost in the loss of ability to make non-reversible payments for non-reversible services. So basically, you can't go to the ATM and keep withdrawing, say, 100 rupees. If you want to withdraw 1500 rupees and you go 15 times and you withdraw 100 rupees, you will be obviously charged after 5 transactions, 25 rupees for every other withdrawal you're doing. So that is one of the problems with the current financial institution. So basically, what Satoshi Nakamoto envisioned was a purely peer-to-peer version of electronic cash that would allow online payments to be sent directly from one party to another without going through a financial institution. As I said, it's a peer-to-peer network, so you don't have to go through a third party. But the model is building such that there are third parties which are providing services for you, but they don't have as much power as banks. Like, they can't be like, let's just stop Bitcoin. They can't stop the entire network or like change the modeling of the currency in that case. So although Bitcoin gained a lot of traction, because and it still is the top most selling cryptocurrency, the most valued, but there are a few limitations, and that kind of those limitations brought about the opened the Pandora's box for blockchain technologies in a way. So Bitcoin was limited only to a single application, which was currency. They did not have any other use cases. It was purely for currency and the problems which it suffered in today's world. So it was basically programmable money. That's all it was. It is still. And all the other currencies which I spoke of derived from Bitcoin were also restricted to the currency application. So they did not have any other application. And to think of it, if that's where the things stopped, the only blockchain you would have for, would have been for currency, and then the banks would have adopted, which they are doing currently. They are making their own cryptocurrencies for their internal processing and stuff. But it wouldn't have been what Satoshi had envisioned as a global currency, like a global network where everyone are involved in it. So after several currency-based blockchains were released, Ethereum came around in 2015. So Ethereum is considered to be the second generation of blockchain, and it is currently the most in thing in blockchain development as such, because it is the most, like it is very, you can fine tune it to the smallest levels. It is very easy to learn at the same time, and you can use existing technologies and port along with it, and you will have a blockchain product which is deployed on a network which is accessible to anyone in the world who wants to access it. So its main motive was to be a distributed computing platform and not a currency. So as I said, Bitcoin was a currency. This wanted to be a distributed computing platform. So the where does the blockchain come in the picture here? In case of Bitcoin, the ledger, basically who paid you, how much they paid you, was meant to like maintain the accounts, basically how much balance you have in it, all those things. But how does blockchain, how will blockchain be used in case of Ethereum? So basically blockchain is used to store the computational code which you have written and the data along with it. So for the people who have done full stack here, it's like you have a backend which is on the blockchain, and you have a database as well which is on the blockchain, and you can access this from anywhere. You don't have to run a server specifically for that. You just have to access the blockchain and you will get the corresponding data for whatever methods you're calling from the local store of database which is in the blockchain. So the code stored on this blockchain was termed as smart contracts, and obviously that is a huge part of Ethereum ecosystem, learning how to write smart contracts. And then this kind of opened the floodgates to blockchain development and a variety of use cases. So after Ethereum, IBM made their own blockchain framework, actually a suite of blockchain frameworks, just not a single one, which is known as the Hyperledger framework. So there are a lot of different use cases, like different industry where you can apply the different Hyperledger framework. Like you can use Hyperledger fabric in one of the use cases, you can use Sawtooth in the other ones. So basically people understood like it is not only restricted to currency, so you can also have computational code on the blockchain, which will obviously like help you in building trustless networks, not just in financial institutions, in other use cases as well, which we will discuss in some time. So as I said, other blockchain platforms inspired by Ethereum were made to meet business needs and user needs, which, as I gave an example, Hyperledger, Cordova. So we will discuss the use cases briefly. So there's this asset tokenization. As I mentioned initially that I worked for this company called Kasha, which raised a lot of money via a crowd sale. So when Ethereum came along, Ethereum was the very first blockchain, if you may, blockchain framework, which kind of raised money via crowd sale. And back then, Microsoft, IBM, everyone put in a lot of money in that because they obviously knew what it, how powerful it was. So the maker, like the founder of Ethereum, the one who created Ethereum, Vitalik Buterin, he came up with a smart contract, which we just discussed a while back, which was kind of like, to be very simple, it was kind of a blockchain within a blockchain, but it's not how it is precisely. But just for you guys to understand, it's like a small Bitcoin blockchain within the Ethereum blockchain. So you can have your own currency. So my ex company, Kasha, had their own currency, Kasha, with CAS as the symbol. And they had a contract on the Ethereum blockchain. That contract basically maintained which person has how many Kasha tokens and so on and so forth. So in that case, you can directly go and buy those tokens from the blockchain rather than going from some other, let's say some other panel which helps you buy it. And there was an option where you can obviously go through the panel as well, because obviously you need the it to be seamless for the users if you're doing a crowd sale. But asset tokenization is one of the biggest use cases. And 2017, which was considered to be a bubble in the blockchain industry, because Bitcoin kind of touched $20,000 that year, and every other currency, they gained thousands of percentage in their price over the span of 2-3 months. So it was because asset tokenization was very easy on the Ethereum platform, and otherwise too, like if you want to start your own blockchain, you just copy the entire code because everything is open source and you start your own blockchain. But as most of them went for the Ethereum smart contract route because that was very easy. You don't have to spend a lot of money for that. And they raised a lot of money basically. So, and you, apart from raising money, you can use those contracts as say you can assign one token to some asset as such. For which I'll come back to the Rajasthan government example, where the use case was such that after 12th, say any girl who scores 80% in the Rajasthan board, the government gives them a bicycle or a laptop or something like that. So the process which they currently had was based on receipts. They'll get a result, they'll get a receipt along with it. They'll have to go to a vendor and the vendor will take the receipt, give them the laptop and do a lot of paperwork for the same. So the solution which we built was something like we will make tokens, say a cycle token or a laptop token. And after the result, we will credit it digitally to the student's account. And the student can go with the app to the vendor and be like, okay, this is my token, and send the token to the vendor by scanning a barcode or something. And the vendor will receive it. They'll give the laptop or the bicycle, whatever the token was meant for it. And there'll be a back processing, which was obviously part of the use case. But for the end user, this was the flow, and this was the entire flow. Like you just exchange tokens in the end, digital tokens, there's no paperwork involved. So this is an example of asset tokenization, which I was talking about. Then there's a use case of digital identity as well, which actually we are trying to develop here at Aegis, which is something of like of the sort like you passed your 10th, you passed your 12th, you have a PAN card, you have a Aadhaar card. So for any job application you have to go, you kind of have to give all these details. So every time you go and you get a Xerox for that and you make a file of it and you pass it on, or you basically a soft copy or something. And then on the company side, the company has to verify whether all this data you're provided is true or not. Like your your past experiences are also included in that. So they kind of call your previous companies, like the companies who actually have a process for this, the corporates generally. They'll also call your college. They'll be like, did this, if you're from a university, then they'll contact the university, check the marks, whether they're right or not. So this is a very time consuming and very cost and effective process. So now if you do get all this identity data onto a blockchain, which is shared by everyone, which is immutable, like which we haven't discussed actually, blockchains, another very key plus point is that it's immutable. Like everyone has to be involved, has to give a vote whether they want to change that data or not, to keep it simple. Like it's a democratic process. So one single person can not go and change any data on the blockchain. So you can have all your certificates, all your identity cards, all your past experiences on the blockchain, and the company, it gets easier for the company too, it gets easier for you too. Like you can give the company the permission to see your data on the blockchain, which you can do, as I said, on Ethereum. And then they'll obviously see your data and they don't need to verify it from anyone else. But this is provided if there's already such an ecosystem in place where there are a lot of companies involved, a lot of institutions involved, a lot of universities involved who are like going along with this and publishing their data onto the blockchain. But that is a very good use case also. And supply chain management, that is actually like the top use case, and everyone is trying to come up with a solution for supply chain management. What is supply chain management? Basically, let's say this remote. So there are buttons on this. There's a body. There's a lot of integrated circuitry inside, circuit boards, wires. So it gets assembled somewhere. It's not like this is how the factory gets it. They don't produce the buttons. They don't like kind of mine for the ores or the make the battery. So they have different vendors for everything else. This is a very simple example. If you scale it up, it becomes very mind-boggling. Let's take a computer for that case. In case of a computer, there's a lot of part coming from different parts of the world. And if you want to maintain your quality, you need to know what the product you're getting is from, like where has it come from. So generally, companies have their own supply chain management softwares which they use, but then which is very discrete. Like the battery people will have their own supply chain, because if you go into a battery also has small parts like the outer cover, the zinc, the lithium ion. So these are also sourced from different parts. like you can actually, it's a rabbit hole you can go deeper and deeper into, like if you just keep on breaking everything. And having such an inclusive solution is not easily possible because people don't trust each other. And blockchain is something which is like a trustless model, which helps you in building infrastructure for the same. So you can have an inclusive blockchain where even your battery supplier, even your wire supplier for that matter, IC integrated circuit boards, and if you go into the battery as well, the lithium ion supplier, everyone is on the blockchain and they are kind of publishing data on the blockchain. Okay, this is what I have done. They can put up basically the numbers as well, the barcode numbers, because all these softwares which are currently being used are used to like tackle counterfeiting, because obviously you get a lot of copy products, and also to maintain the quality of your products, whether the parts which you are using are correct or not. And it might not seem a big deal, but almost every company has to go through it, and every company which is making a physical product as such. So a lot of people are trying for solutions in the supply chain management domain, but not like very profitable as solutions have come across. And then there is the energy market as well. Like you can have the energy data on the blockchain. It works just similarly like how financial institutions work, or even asset tokenization for that matter. Like everyone has their energy consumption data on the blockchain, and the billing is also being done on the blockchain. And this is not happening currently in India, but in foreign countries, people are putting up solar panels on their houses and they're selling the energy back to the government. So in that case, you can see a very good use case coming across, and just not just to the government, you can sell it to anyone else as well if a blockchain is involved. Basically, you can just do the transaction on the blockchain. And then the healthcare industry. So I'll go back to the example which we have done. It was for clinical trials basically. So clinical trials is also a very long and lengthy process where some pharmaceutical company wants to make a new medicine. So they come up with this entire elaborate steps which a patient is supposed to go through to like test the medicine, whether it's working or not. So, but the pharma companies do not directly go to the patient, they go via a doctor or a hospital or a clinic. So the doctor, the pharma companies tell the doctor that this is the form, you need to get the consent of the patient on this. Okay, I know what I'm doing. And the doctor has a responsibility that he has to explain everything to the patient. And then when the doctor explains to the patient signs it, the doctor does not give all the data back to the pharma companies. The pharma companies need not know the name. Actually, they should not know the name of the patient. And so there's a lot of permissioning involved here. And if you go into the details, the steps in the trial might also include that the patient has to take a blood test. They have to take some other kind of test which the doctor does not provide or the hospital does not provide. So they have to go to a third party lab for that. So even this case becomes very complex, and you permission data is involved. Basically, the pharma companies do not want that one doctor's data is shared with another doctor's data. And they also do not want the patient's data being shared across doctors or even to them for that matter. So we came up for a solution in this trustless environment as well for a pharma company in USA. And then there's land registry. It kind of works similar to currency. Like you can put this data on the blockchain. You don't have to maintain all those heavy paperwork for your land, and you just put the data on the blockchain, and everyone can just see, okay, this guy is the owner of this land. It kind of makes things seamless and easier. So there are a lot of financial use cases as well, like if you go deeper into it. And you might not know, but there are a lot of blockchain frameworks in the market. So the next diagram shows you the same thing. So there's data storage, there's StoreJ and Pure Nova. There's also, so this is kind of a distributed cloud, if you may, where everyone stores their data and it gets replicated on all the networks. Someone will ask, why do I want that? There are permissioning options in that, so that no one can see your data, but the data is redundantly stored on different locations, so that in case your computer goes down, you can get it back from someone else. And then there are trading platforms. As I said, now rather than having a lot of use cases, the blockchain industry has become a tokenized industry where people are coming up with use cases, okay, that I'll make this, I'll make that, but they're having a token for the same thing. And they're selling the token for the crowd sale, which I just mentioned a while back. So, obviously, and they sell the tokens later on when the crowd sale is done, the prices, it's just like a normal stock. If your company is doing well, the prices will go up. So there's a very huge trading industry within blockchain, cryptocurrencies, if you may, where they have come up with, if you think of a trade exchange, that also is a very centralized institution. Like all the power rests in the hand of the exchange. The trades you make go through the exchange. So to tackle that, people have come up with decentralized trading exchanges as well, where you can go and trade these tokens. So there's no single authority which can like run, because in case of cryptocurrencies, people have actually gone like taken your money, and the exchanges have taken the money, the exchanges got hacked, so all your money has gone in a way. And gaming is also a very good domain where it is being used, specifically gambling, because a lot of hash functions are used. If you guys don't know what a hash function is, it is something which generates random numbers, to keep it simple. So in a lot of gambling games, although gambling is illegal in India, but abroad it's not illegal as much. So it's a very good use case for that. And a lot of gambling games are based on the blockchain, on the Ethereum network itself. And you can use it for currency exchange and remittances as well. So now it is being banned. Like if you've been following lately, by June, July, the Indian government is thinking of banning it. The reason being, one is that a lot of money laundering is happening because people are like converting their cash into Bitcoin. And other reason is that it is a very good option for remittances. Like you get charged somewhere around 2 to 5% if you want to send money across. That's a very small number, which I'm saying it increases actually. So what you can do is, you can say you wanted to send 1 lakh rupees. You are being charged 2,000, 5,000 bucks for that. So you just buy Bitcoin worth 1 lakh rupees. And because it's not like Bitcoin, you can send it to anyone in the world. You will send it to someone else, say in the United States. They'll receive it, they'll convert it. There's no remittance charges for that. So that's a good use case, in financial use case, which is being used. And as you can see, the third example there is Ripple. Ripple is another blockchain framework which is centralized. It's not decentralized like Bitcoin, but it is decentralized in the sense that a lot of banks are involved, and that too international banks. So you can exchange Ripple tokens as currency. Like if you want to give someone, say, INR, you can give as a bank, not as an end user. You can give them some Ripple, and those Ripple will be considered as INR according to the exchange date. So that is interbank remittance, basically what Ripple is helping with. And they are actually doing a very good job in that. A lot of Indian banks have also been onboarded for the same. And as I said, P2P transfers, the solution which I gave was a P2P where you wanted to send money across. And there are a lot of non-financial use cases as well. So you might not know about this, but there are social media websites on the blockchain where if you put up posts, the likes which you're getting, you'll be earning money on those social media platforms. And now that money is in form of the token of that. As an example, it's Steam it. So Steam tokens, you'll be paid in Steam tokens. Now you'll be like, what is it worth? It's worth $2 and $2.50. So if a post of yours gets enough like for you to earn, say, 100 Steam tokens, you are almost earning $250 for that post, which you don't earn in case of Facebook or anything else. And even in case of YouTube, the ad revenue is very small. So, and they have a very elaborate network where even like basically for curating the content also you are being paid, for liking someone else's post also you are being paid, for any activity which you are doing on the social media you are being paid. And that's completely decentralized. There's no central authority which is paying you. Like the algorithm itself pays you when you're doing that. And as authentication and authorization, those land registry examples and even the digital identity example kind of come under that. And as you can see, there's digital identity as well. So the names which you're seeing under it are basically the real life implementations which people have done on all these sectors. And there's still a lot of scope for the same. And it's basically becoming the next go-to technology. And after discussing about blockchain for so long, if someone asks you what a blockchain is, it's simply it's basically a distributed database. You can also have a blockchain with a SQL database, but you won't have those cryptographic properties as such, which kind of prevent you from changing it. Blockchain is like unchangeable distributed database. So there are a lot of use cases which you can go through, and here at Aegis we have also come up with a few projects which obviously comprise from these use cases, and we can have a working solution and obviously go and sell it to people if it actually works. And a lot of big companies, like as I said, the supply chain companies, Maruti, Mahindra, they are constantly searching for new alternatives for their current supply chain management tools because it is very cumbersome as such. So I'll take some questions if there are any right now. Yeah, we'll share the Smriti Ranjan, we'll share the document.
Somebody has asked, is blockchain is hackable?
I can't see that actually.
So many comments has come up. See, it's here, I'll show you.
Okay, so someone has kind of said blockchain is hackable, and I'll answer that person in a while. Kapil is asking how a person from technical background can work in it, or is it's just a framework, what kind of innovation is in there. So I have actually gone through it on a very high level. There is a lot of innovation, like it is actually very beautiful when you kind of understand what's going on in there. It's very difficult for you, mathematically very difficult for you to hack it, as some guy has suggested that it's hackable. And a lot of data structures is being used for the same, a lot of cryptography, digital signatures is being used. So it's at the very crossroads of different fields in within computer science, and it's a very nice final product which comes out of it, using data structures, cryptography, networking, even game theory is used in it. You'll come to know when you go through the courses in detail. There's game theory, there's monetary economics, there's a lot of stuff going on. It's not a very simple framework to build, say, websites or something. Like, although there are frameworks which make it easy for you to build it, but it's not just simply a framework to be such. You need to understand the details to be able to use the framework in a better way. So Prashant is thinking that blockchain is hackable. Theoretically, yes, it is hackable, but if you want to hack it, you'll have, even if you use the entire resources in the world, say you use every computer in the world to say hack the Bitcoin blockchain, which is the first blockchain, which is the oldest blockchain, and in a way it's like there might be, just to like go along with your blockchain is hackable thing, it's very old, it's outdated technology. So if you want to hack it, you use every computer in the world, including supercomputers, including quantum computers, which are currently there, you'll take at least 1 million years to hack it. So you can try, you can go ahead and very well try and then laugh about it. Okay, I think all the other questions are regarding cybersecurity and data analysis. So, okay, I'm done. Stack development, which will start in like a couple of minutes. Thanks a lot.
Good evening, guys. Good evening again. My name is Bhupesh Darya. So those who have joined late, so thank you, Shabahat, giving fantastic perspective about blockchain. Now I will be spending couple of minutes on full stack. What is full stack, and what are the career aspects in full stack, and I will talk about briefly about our program in postgraduate program in full stack, which we are starting in association with IBM in Bangalore, Pune and Mumbai campus, as well as part time, right? So a recap, Aegis is having industry collaboration with IBM, Nvidia, UbiTech and AWS Educate, and AWS Educate will play a major role because you'll have a lot of course material available on AWS, on DevOps, on Node.js, on JavaScript, on AWS cloud. World class cloud resources will be available, plus also you'll be able to use AWS cloud to really develop any web application or websites, or you can really host your machine learning models over here. And the certification you'll be getting from IBM. Now let's see what are the trends across the world on full stack. So as you can really see, this is like a HackerRank 2018 developer skills report, and this says that 24.1% it's a top leading role full stack developer, and followed by that is a software engineer, and then the back end developer, and then the software architect, and the front end developer, and then you will see a data scientist, so which is one of the very super hyped role which I spoke about in my first session. But by and large, if we see, one of the top most role which is high in demand is a full stack developer. So Shabahat was talking about blockchain, I spoke about data science, AI. So in any application, any website, all these blockchain, or be it data science or AI, all these stuff will be working on a full-fledged software. They will be part of the full-fledged software. So full stack developers are primarily responsible for building up that body, right? And blockchain or data science or all or AI or machine learning or NLP will be part of these bigger piece of the software application, right? Let us move further. This morning I searched on Naukri, try to see what are the scope of full stack developer here in India, and you can clearly see, let me read it for you, those who are watching on mobile. The 15,254 full stack developer jobs are there, unfulfilled jobs are there in Naukri.com in India. This I am talking about 4 hours back result. Let us see, and similar kind of, so I also search on Indeed, you guys can also do it. Indeed, there are roughly around 5,400 jobs are listed there on the full stack on Indeed.com. So full stack is a very prominent skill set which is needed. Full stack developers are just like a superman, and the full stack software developer, their job is to really build end to end software product, right from front end to the back end, and everything what these guys they do. And if you see from the pay scale, which is the job site which actually does the survey, full stack developer, software developer is one of the highest growth rate they have seen, right? And with the median salary of almost $77,000 in North America. So there is a scope in India, and there is a scope in even the developed world. And as I told you, full stack developers, they are the superman, and they handle end to end software development, right from front end to the back end to database. They are responsible to even put up entire software, this product on the cloud, because now all these products are actually working on the cloud, right? So this is this picture actually clearly describe what a traditional full stack developer is. There is a front end, so they will be doing the front end, they will be using Bootstrap, Angular, React, right, JavaScript. they will be using the database, it could be MongoDB, MySQL, right. they will be using Apache server, they will be using a lot of backend technologies, level framework for PHP, Java, Python, right. So plus they will be proficient on the cloud deployment, so they will be good at Google Cloud, Bluemix Cloud, they will be good on Microsoft Azure Cloud. So they are conversant with working with all these cloud platforms, right. This is the job trend, skill and job trend analysis what we did at Aegis. Whenever we launch any program, we actually do the analysis about what kind of skills trends are there in the market, and you can really clearly see the key skills is of course the software development, SQL, Java, HTML, JavaScript, jQuery, Python, right, PHP, Linux, right, Ajax, CSS, all these skills are coming. And if you see, and of course Bengaluru is the leading job market for these skill sets. What you have to really learn to become a full stack developer, so you have to really learn front end technologies like HTML, HTML5, CSS, JavaScript, AngularJS, ReactJS, native, React Native, Bootstrap, PHP, right. You need to really understand backend, PHP has come on the front end, backend technologies like Python, Java, Spring, Django, Node.js, Docker, PHP, database like MySQL, right, Redis, MongoDB, Elasticsearch, Cassandra, all those stuff you need to really know. You also need to really have some understanding about mobile app development, which could be hybrid or Android or iOS. Of course, there will be very specialist guys, those who will be developing these applications, mobile applications, but having some understanding will really help you to really work in a team, right. You also need to really have exposure to other areas like DevOps, CUDA, Git, right, for version control, Selenium, so also Sonar, Jira, right, for project management. So all these stuff you need to really have understanding. You also need to be exposed, as I told you, about cloud. And at Aegis, we have also come up with a special track. So most of, as in my first session in AI and data science, I spoke about how you guys need to really build the smart softwares in smart product. And to bring this smartness, you also need to really have some basic understanding about machine learning. So in this program, we've also put up some special track on machine learning over Azure, machine learning over AWS, Google TensorFlow JS, which is like a front-end technology in a JavaScript. So you can really take any deep learning models like for facial detection or say any kind of machine learning model or deep learning model which you want to really run on a browser on Chrome, you can actually do with this, right? And then you can also pick up some stuff on big data. You can also pick up some electives on blockchain, right, on security, cloud security, right? So we considering there is a huge requirement in industry about full stack developer, and not many institutions, or rather there is no institution in India which offers a full-time master's program in full stack development. Aegis and IBM came together and we launched India's first postgraduate program in full stack development. And this certification essentially comes from IBM. And this program is an 11-month duration program and covers almost everything which I was talking about, front-end, back-end, database, cloud, DevOps, and then the special tracks on machine learning and all those kind of stuff. This program is certification is given by IBM. This program is delivered by the experts of IBM and Aegis. This is a 45 credit unit program. What essentially it means that each course is 1 credit unit to 3 credit unit. And then you will be doing internships. So after 11 month program, you will be going for a 2 to 3 month industry internship, which will actually help you to really convert these internships into the final placement. This is a globally acceptable credit structure which we follow. All North American master's degree, they are minimum 36 credit unit to 45 credit unit. This program is a 45 credit unit. You have to do 15 projects, which means essentially in every technology or piece which we are teaching you, you have to really do some project. So you will build some project on front end, back end, right? You will build the complete product. You may build an e-commerce site. You may build up some blockchain product, right? So you will build some working prototype product and you will completely deploy it on the web, and with your team you will also deploy it on the mobile, right? And those who are interested to take it further, you will go into say acquiring some machine learning expertise as well. Abhinav Anand asked for the fees of this program is 1.75 lakh rupees, and this program is available in full time mode as well as part time mode. So in Bangalore, Pune and Mumbai, you can do either full time. Those who are freshers or those who have quit the job, they can really do full time program. Or those who are already into existing job, you can do it on weekend in Bombay, Bangalore and Pune. Bombay, we have a campus in Hiranandani Gardens, Powai, and Bangalore we have in MG Road, and Pune we have in Magarpatta Cyber City, which is Saturday, Sunday you can do. So as I already told you, this is a pictorial description. So we will be covering jQuery, we will be covering the mean stack, Laravel, which is like a PHP framework, React, JavaScript, Hibernate, Flask, Node, Docker, right? Java, Bootstrap, right? CSS, Angular, HTML5, Jira, DevOps, Git, web design and development, right? Microservices, you have to do capstone project, you have to really understand Microsoft Azure, AWS, web services. So hundreds of stuff you will be covering. This is one of the most comprehensive program available on this planet, at least in full-time mode. We have one of the best faculties who will hold your hand, and you will do the hands-on stuff, you will do the project which I already spoke about, and this program will give you an edge over everybody else, and since there is already requirement, you this program will make you the industry ready. Any question guys you have, if I can really answer? This program is going to start in month of August. 26th of August, we'll be starting this program. Abhinav, sir, is it possible to complete all these in 11 months? Because I know only Java itself takes 6 months to complete along with all the services in Spring. Abhinav, you're right. It is extremely compressed program. We are not claiming that we'll make you an expert. What we are claiming that we will help you to start your journey and give you a complete view about the development of the software project. what is happening that when you really start with a front end or a back end or a database, you don't completely get the whole end to end view about the entire project. And anyway, full stack developers, they are under criticism that they are the jack of all, but they are not master of none, right? Which is kind of a weakness of full stack developer, which eventually over the years they gain expertise on each of the area. And you rightly say that Java is difficult to really gain mastery, but those who are not having very comfortable with, specifically comfortable with Java, they can really take a track of using Python, right? So you can really take a complete full stack path on a Python, you can take complete path on the JavaScript, right? And Java is one of the most difficult, right? So those who are not comfortable with the coding, they can really either choose PHP or JavaScript or maybe Python track, right? But this program is not, the idea of this program is not to make you an expert. The idea of this program is to give you 360 degree idea about building up a product end to end, right? So that you can really take the help of experts in some particular area if you are finding difficulty. But you at your own, you can build some MVP, minimum viable project, right? So that's the whole idea. In that case, what should be the difference between pursuing the same course from Udemy versus pursuing it from Aegis? Udemy cheap is okay, fantastic. So Abhinav, Udemy, or why you have to really even waste your money on Udemy, you can really go on YouTube. So whichever the technologies what I spoke about, Node.js, JavaScript, Java, Angular, React, all those stuff, you will find tons of material which is available on the YouTube. Of course, all these MOOC courses, they are fantastic courses, and lot of people, thousands of people are learning over there. These tools are good for those who have very high degree of discipline, and they have already been exposed to some kind of technology. So, for example, if you are working already into this field on front end, you have been working for 2, 3 years, 4 years, you already have some exposure, so then it becomes much easier for you to really grasp those concepts theoretically. Today the IT industry has become very competitive, and the IT industry is not hiring based on how much you know about React or Angular or JavaScript or PHP. What they are asking, show me what you can do for me, and they determine this based on what you have done. So companies are essentially asking you to demonstrate your capability to build the product, and you can only show that if you have built some products. So what Aegis is striving, we are not trying to really compete, and I am nowhere a good person to really give you comparison between Udemy and Aegis. But what I can really tell, that what we are trying to essentially do is to not only to give you the depth of the theory, but simultaneously hold your hand and help you to make the products. So tomorrow when you go and face the campus interview, you are able to show to employer that look, this is these many projects, 15 projects I have done. I have built some prototype, and at the same time I also know the deep theory. And as you yourself said, that it takes 6 months time to learn the Java. You can't learn Java on say 6 hours course on Udemy. This course takes you into depth, at the same time on the breadth, plus it helps you to really do the project, right? But of course you're free to really go and learn if you have a self discipline on these MOOC courses. They are extremely good, and thousands of people are learning. Yeah, they're good alternates. Any other question, guy? Okay, thank you so much, guys. And now, so I will invite Ritin, and Ritin will give you in 5 minutes' time, will tell you how you can really apply for this full stack development. And then again, I will come back after 5 minutes to take your session on cybersecurity.
Yes, a very good evening to all of you who are attending this session live. So many individuals, because I was just checking the chats as well. So most of you have that query that how to apply, how to go ahead. So quickly, I'll just summarize you in 5 minutes of how to go ahead, how to apply to this program. So I need your help, Aditya, as well. We'll have to go through the... So this is, I'll be skipping those slides. So this is the program we have talked about, which is a post-graduate program we offer with IBM into full stack development. Can you please go to that link, website link? Okay. Yes. So now you can see once you, okay. So now once you click on that particular page, you can search. So let me just quickly take you to the slide. Could you please take me to the slide? Okay, let it open. Take me to the slide. Yes. Okay. Just click on the present. Yeah. Okay, this is the program what we have talked about. So we have already talked about the structure, the duration, 11 months, 2 months of internship and placements we offer. 6 days a week will be the session. Also, we are offering the executive modes as well of delivery, which will be on Saturday and Sunday. Duration, credit structure 45, and commencement date is 19th August, in which we are offering this program. We are commencing this program. And applications are open till 31st May. If you are looking forward to apply for this program, please do apply till 31st May. We are accepting the application. Okay. So this Career Management Center access will be there for the participants, which help the participants for providing them with the excellent internship and placements. Okay, the financial aid is also available. If you guys think that, okay, you fit, you feel that you have got these credentials, what we have mentioned, if you feel that, if you think that you are fit in any of the categories, like if you have 90, 90, 85, 85, 85, 80, so these are the slabs what we have got with us, which is the financial aids what we do provide to the participants. That will be 10%, 20%, 30%, 50 and 100% will be the relaxation on the fees what we do charge for the program. And also the bank loans, we do have the tie-up with various financial institution who disburse the education loan to the participants, and that typically it will take 5 to 6 days to get it reimbursed. Now coming to the application process, first you have to fill the online application. So once the application would receive, your interview would be scheduled, which will be a personal run-off interview or a Skype. We are conducting the interviews on pan India basis. So second, we are conducting the interviews in Mumbai. 9th, we are conducting the interviews in Delhi. 16th, we are going to Bangalore, 16th June, 17th in Hyderabad, and 23rd in Kolkata. If you think that we are in your city or proximity to that, you can come and have personal run-off interview. Or if you are applying for the executive mode of deliveries, then you can apply for the, or the live interactive session, you can apply for the Skype interviews could be conducted. So in case you get through and shortlisted on the very same day, we extend you the admission offer for the program. How you can go ahead, how you can proceed, there are two ways. Either you can check out, or maybe you can land up on our website, that is www.aegis.edu.in, or maybe you can go to www.muniversity.mobi/aegis. I would request my team to please provide the coordinates where they can directly apply. Already I believe we have already provided you with the links where you can apply. So this is how the page will looks like, in which you will find the different courses what we have walked you through. Click on the particular page of the program. This is how the page will looks like. You will see an apply button on the top left side of the page. Click on that apply button, fill up the application, and once you are done, this is how the page looks like, I mean, which will be the login page. You can log in by using your Google, Facebook, or login or LinkedIn credentials, and you can apply for the program. Once we receive the application, your interview will be scheduled. So this is all how to apply, because this is the most of the individuals who are asking me how to go ahead and apply for the program. So now we would like to invite Mr. Dahiria for walking you through, or maybe giving you the entire exposure or 360 degree view about the cyber security. May I please invite you on stage, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ritin. Thank you so much.
Presenting you Aegis. School of Cybersecurity, the best school for postgraduate program in cybersecurity in association with IBM. Ginni Rometty, CEO IBM, said that cybercrime is the greatest threat to every company in the world. Per Forbes, cybersecurity job market is expected to grow to more than $170 billion in just 4 years. Cybersecurity spending to exceed $1 trillion. Unfilled cybersecurity jobs will reach 1.5 million by end of 2019. Cisco reports 6 million available cybersecurity jobs globally. Looking at the huge gap in skills for cybersecurity, Aegis launched Postgraduate Program, or PGP, in cybersecurity in association with IBM. PGP certification by IBM. Program taught by IBM cybersecurity experts and industry scholar gurus and top faculties. Launch your career in cybersecurity with Aegis School of Cybersecurity. Exposure to IBM Cybersecurity Lab and software. Add wings to your career and explore today about postgraduate program in cybersecurity in association with IBM at www.aegis.edu.in. Presenting you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm glad to see that all of you here is still having a lot of energy. You have joined since 2 o'clock and it's now close to 5 o'clock, and after 3 hours, I really appreciate that you have still left with a lot of energy. And today, now we are at the end of our session and this last session on the cybersecurity. And for next 15 minutes, I will be quickly giving you a brief idea about what are the trends in cybersecurity, what is cybersecurity, what kind of assets we are trying to protect. And then I will also talk about the joint program which we launched along with IBM, postgraduate program in cybersecurity, India's first program, most comprehensive program, and how this program can help you to launch your career into cybersecurity. So welcome all of you again. My name is Bhupesh Dharia. I'm a CEO of Aegis School of Data Science. And so a recap. So we have industry collaboration with IBM. IBM have set up the cybersecurity lab at Aegis. We also have alliance with NVIDIA for deep learning. So we are teaching machine learning and deep learning as a part of cybersecurity. And AWS Educate, which gives you access to the clouds. We are also teaching AWS cloud security, and there are tons of AWS resources and cloud platform which you get free of cost as a Aegis student as a part of this alliance. So Ginni Rometty, IBM's chairman and CEO, says very relevant statement that cybercrime is the greatest threat to every company in this world. And I will go further ahead, it's not every company, it's the greatest threat to the civilization in every country, every company and the society today. So today's wars are not done, the physical wars. Today countries are not fighting, these countries are engaging into the cyber wars. They are state threat actors, these cyber criminals, these cyber terrorists. These cyber armies are employed by the states and the countries, and they use against other countries. And there has been many instances wherein a lot of attacks which happened on our country, India, and these attacks were originated from countries like China, countries like Pakistan. So it is a real threat. This threat is not only for the company. This has become a real threat for the entire country and the society and for the business and even the individuals. There has been many cases wherein individuals been hacked, right? And there were ransom virus, right? people really siphon money through their wallets, they hack their mobile phone, they really siphon money from their bank accounts. So it is a greatest threat, not only to countries, individual beings, societies and everybody. Say 50 years back or 30 years back, if you wanted to really make money, the best way was to really become a bank robber. But now today, people are becoming the cyber criminals, and they are not only the hobbyists, they are sitting with a multi-million dollar or billion dollar funding, and they are equipped with the very sophisticated tools today, right? if we see from, so we have seen the darker side, let's see what is there for you as a cyber professional. Since the whole world is going under digitization, India has gone massive digitization in last government's ruling. we need to really protect our assets, and to protect those assets, we require cyber security professionals. And as per the US News and World Report, cyber security ranked 8th on the list of top 100 best jobs in US. As per Cisco report says that currently more than a million jobs available in cybersecurity in US alone, and roughly around 6 million jobs globally. This is too high a number, this is a staggering number we can really see. There are roughly around 1.5 million jobs, which is close to 15 lakh jobs, unfulfilled jobs in this year. but India's GDP is roughly around $3 trillion, and India is among top 10 world economies. And by 2021, the cyber crime damage cost will hit the double of the India's GDP. This I'm talking about worldwide, $6 trillion, which is a huge, huge, huge number. Intel report says that there is likely to be 200 billion IoT devices. Current world population is roughly around 7.2 billion, and these IoT devices are going to really surpass our human population. And all these IoT devices need to be secured. We are wearing Fitbit, and imagine that what kind of risk you can really have, that if your Fitbit is showing that you have abnormality in your health. How about if connected cars are hacked and you're not able to really put a brake on your car and car goes out of the control? How about you're having a paper robot in your home, or your child is playing with a robot and this robot became a rogue? And all these things are not a distant dreams. And all these things are possible if people really hack into this, right? So no more the traditional understanding and knowledge about the security can really prepare you for the new challenges which this world is going to really face you. Let's see what cybersecurity is all about. And even before we get into that, let's see what are we trying to really protect? What are the assets we are trying to really protect? All right. And this is the framework which we have created at Aegis. That what kind of asset you need to really protect today. You need to really protect a physical infrastructure. Like for example, today I am giving this session in Aegis campus, which is on 7th floor. I am sitting over here. This entire infrastructure, physical infrastructure, need to be protected. There are security guards are out there. There is a biometric access is there in this room. There are CCTV cameras in this class, right? All those security stuff is there to really protect the physical infrastructure. But still, hackers sitting in Ukraine or China or anywhere can really get into my mobile phone or this laptop and disrupt whatever the live broadcast we are doing. And how they can really enter? They need not really breach into the physical infrastructure or come through the door. They can really enter into this system through the network. So the network need to be protected, right? And when I say network, this is like a traditional copper wire or your optical fiber, your switches and the Wi-Fi network which you have built, or I am using my Jio connection on LTE. This need to be protected. So these are new realities which is coming in. You need to really protect your application. So you might have protected your network, but you need to really protect your application. So this whole broadcast is going on the web at the same time. Some of you are watching it on your mobile phone. And these applications need to be protected. If there is a bug in these applications, imagine that you are using a mobile banking application and some spyware is running into that app, or if there is a bug into that app, this can really create a haywire into the whole stuff. And there have been instances last month wherein Air India flights were shut down for almost 6 to 7 hours. And what happened, like hackers got into their system and they deleted all the details about the bookings, and the operations were affected across the globe, not only in India. So applications need to be protected. And then there is a valuable data about the customers, and Facebook was under fire for that. This data need to be protected. Today data has become oil and whosoever has the data will be able to really mine that data, and this mining can really bring poison, or this mining can really bring any kind of stuff. So this data is valuable. Imagine that UDI data, Aadhaar card data of India, how critical this data is. You have your biometrics, right? You have all your details, and imagine that if criminals really get into this data, and how they can really use your data, that is beyond your imagination, right? Let's not go in that direction. So data, we understand data need to be protected. Now, where is this your application and data is lying? These applications are lying in your servers, and today most of your servers are lying into the cloud, which could be public cloud and which could be private cloud. So of course AWS or Azure, these or Google Cloud, they are protected. But how do you really take care of the access into those clouds? How do you really protect those clouds is anybody's nightmare. And today, lot of these data is being generated through IoT devices. And imagine that a refinery, a oil pipeline is going through a desert, and there are a bunch of IoT devices are over there to really check any kind of malfunction or any kind of a threat. And if these IoT devices really fail to really check that somebody is trying to really cut this pipeline through the laser beam, what kind of accident or what kind of hazards it can really lead, we have no idea. So these IoT devices need to be protected, right? As I told you, like robot or these autonomous vehicles, they are the new angle, they need to be protected. The access control has to be there, and at the same time the people need to be trained, because the majority of the attacks, roughly around 60-65% of the attacks, are done because of the social engineering. You can really protect your database, you can protect your physical infrastructure, cloud, database and everything, but humans are vulnerable. How about I really pay somebody money to really give me the data, or money to really give me share the password, or if money doesn't work, I can really say threaten them, right? Or we can steal their devices, or we can really lure them. And there has been instances wherein Pakistani mole lured Indian defense personnel, and they lured them to really download some applications on mobile phone, and through which they hacked, and those servers, then they actually hacked through the servers via Russia. And eventually we could really figure it out, and my friend Amit Dubey, who is a joint CTO of Tech Mahindra, he was one of the instrumental guy in terms of identifying and finding what kind of threats were there, right? So all these things need to be protected, and this is the framework, modern framework of asset protection we have built at Aegis, that unlike when I did my engineering in telecommunication way back in 95, that time the security was only about network, but now today the security has expanded into so many areas, and we have also included a course on blockchain security, right? How do you really protect the blockchain? We have put up a cryptography, because you need to really build secure algorithms. And then apart from that, you need to really take care of the laws. You need to really, most of the modern attacks are being done by the machines. So machines are making the attacks, and when machines are making the attacks, machines are attacking you, human beings are incapable of protecting themselves with the attacks which is driven by the machines. So if we have to really protect ourselves, we need to retrain a machine against the machine. And that's where we also have included machine learning into our the program. So looking at this framework of the entire asset which need to be secured, this is the now the new definition of the cyber security. Cyber security is the practice of defending your organization's digital assets from unauthorized access, attack or damage, right? And when I say all the digital assets, I have mentioned about cloud, database, application, right, IoT devices, everything, right? And this is, so we do our own analysis about the skill set which are needed, most talked about the skill set around the world or in India. So we did the India analysis about almost 100,000 jobs. And these are the key skills which we could really figure it out. And one of the important thing you will see is network security. So network security is a normal, is fits into our mind that network security is one of the most important thing. But Python, why Python is needed, it's something which does not really get into our head, right? So this kind of analysis also shows that yes, Python is very important, and one of the largest jobs available in cybersecurity is not any ethical hacking or penetration testing. It's more into what you say is application security. You need to really build the secure softwares. We'll just come, Anand, and we will just come on the course structure once I finish another 2-3 minutes time. What are the jobs available, top jobs? Chief Information Security Officer, Cyber Security Data Scientist, which is one of the top highest paying job available in this country and around the world. Since we also offer the cyber data science program and blockchain program, you have a huge opportunity to pick up electives from there. And anyway, as a part of cyber security program, we have put in into machine learning into that. Information Security Analyst, Penetration Tester, Security Architect, and there's so many other jobs which you can really read. which are available in this area. These are the salary figures. You can go through this presentation yourself, but jobs are huge, and one of the good thing in this, like if you see lead software security engineer, if you see these are the guys, those who get the highest salary, and their salaries are higher than even Chief Information Security Officer. So what I was talking about, the developing secure software can give you more money, and one of the most exciting areas in this area. What are the new trends in cyber security? Cognitive security, which is led by IBM, is getting in a full-fledged way into the traditional security. And cognitive security, so all as a human being, in a, we are judged being based on our cognitive ability. This cognitive security got into cyber security, and cognitive security uses machine learning and natural language processing to mimic the way human brain functions. Because you have to really analyze millions of logs, millions of incidents which happens around the world, and it is impossible for a human being to actually identify the pattern out of that. And cognitive security and machine learning actually helps in doing that and finding the pattern and helping the human being in terms of really protecting themselves with again any unwanted threats. Why there is a need? So there are so many programs in information security or cyber security, or there are thousands of certifications, like CISA, like network security, pen testing security, right? You have ethical hacking, hundreds of courses are there. So why there is a need of this full-time postgraduate program in cybersecurity? These are 3 points which I would like to really highlight. Most of the programs, they are running in silo, and none of the program what we have analyzed gives you a holistic coverage of 360 degree aspect, which I spoke about. And let me repeat it again, which is like a database, which is network, which is cloud, which is IoT, which is cyber laws, which is like machine learning. There's no single program around the world which actually gives you this kind of area. I have analyzed most of the MSc and master's program in Europe, and I could not really find any master's program which actually teaches you machine learning or Python or cyber laws. Either they are too management, or they are only sticking to traditional security aspect. Even they don't give you inputs on blockchain security or IoT security or these aspects. Another reason, most of these training programs, certification programs, isolated programs, they are monolithic programs, and you keep on acquiring these certifications in your lifetime, and in your lifetime you will be spending roughly around 35 to 40 lakh rupees to acquire the stacks of these certifications to get the 360 degree knowledge, and you can't really wait. So what you want to really acquire, that as a, imagine that you become a head of security, and as a head of the security, you may not be expert on each of the area, but you will be knowing almost every area, and then you will pick up one or two areas where you will have the deeper understanding, and that's what this course is all about. So that if you come from the legacy of network security, you will say, okay, what cloud security is just air, right? But you will have the understanding about cloud security, you also have the understanding about the security laws and everything. So we launched this postgraduate program in cybersecurity in association with IBM last year, and the first batch is running in Bangalore. The next batch will be taking in July in now Bangalore, Pune and Bombay full time. At the same time, weekend part time program for those who are working executives. This is the joint certification which IBM offers. So this is the joint certification comes from IBM and Aegis. And IBM has fantastic tool called IBM QRadar, which is part of this curriculum. IBM's cognitive security is a part of this curriculum. The highlights, the PGP program is delivered jointly by IBM. You get the certification from IBM. It means like IBM is known globally, so you can really take this certification anywhere. you get exposure to IBM security lab and software. This is again 45 credit unit program. If you recall, I told you about that all the master's degree in North America and Europe, they are measured into credit hours. Europe, it is typically 36 credit hours, which essentially means 12 courses. And North America, it is typically 36 hours, credit hours to 45 credit unit or credit hours. This program is minimum 45 credit unit. What it means that you can also acquire 50 credit unit or 54 or 60 or 70, it all up to you. So there is no upper limit, but there is a minimum limit, right? And after 11 months, you will be undergoing 2 to 3 month industry internship. These credit structures is globally acceptable credit structure. So tomorrow, if you want to really go for the PhD, universities will give you the red carpet treatment. Anand, is this program suitable to person who does not have any much knowledge about networking field? Yes, Anand, you can do this program without having any understanding about networking, because we will be teaching you the networking foundation of networking in this program, and then we'll take you into the network security. So as I told you, this program is available in three models. One is full-time program, which is 6 days a week, and then weekend program Saturday, Sunday in Pune, Bangalore and Bombay. And third is online executive program, which is again weekend program. And this is not canned recorded sessions just like a Udemy. These are the live interactive sessions, the way you are talking to me. Unfortunately, YouTube does not really offer you to use your voice or a video. Our platform, which we use, there you can really talk to me using your video or audio with our faculty. We have one of the best faculties for this program, Chief Information Security of Wipro. He teaches. Jairaj, he's one of the leading faculty in Bangalore campus. He teaches different CIOs of different leading organizations. They come and teach. IBM experts, they come and teach. So this program is delivered by one of the best people in this industry. This program is going to start in July, right? 21st July, this program is starting from the 21st July in all three campuses, full time and weekend. You can apply and you can get in touch with Ritin or Yashashri or Manish or Apeksha or Noble. They will guide you. Those who are in Bangalore, they can visit physical campus and meet Noble over there and our faculty Jaraj and discuss. This is the course curriculum snapshot I am talking, giving you. This is like a core courses. So we'll be teaching you machine learning for cybersecurity. We'll be teaching you ethical hacking. We'll be teaching you fundamental courses in cloud security, application security by IBM, foundation courses on security identity management by IBM, foundation course in security access management by IBM, security engineering, application security, network security, security and privacy, design analysis of algorithm, capstone project. You have to do a capstone project. Raju, I know knowledge about, it's a no knowledge or no knowledge. I think I presume that this is no knowledge about cybersecurity. I don't completed BTech, but I have 2 years experience in networking. You can take a chance, Raju, since you have already experience. You have to really convince the interviewer, and I think since you have the experience, I think you can really put forward some point that why you should be given admission. But I think you are a valuable person. You can really learn these stuff, right? You should apply. Applied cryptography, digital forensic, penetration testing, vulnerability assessment, cloud security. In cloud security, we give you exposure on AWS cloud security and Amazon cloud security. Then pattern recognition and so many other electives which you can check on our website, which is blockchain security, right? Which is data science, right? So there are tons of other electives you can pick up. Abhinav, for working executives, yes, this program is available for working executives for weekend. So which city you are based in? So if you are based in Bombay, Pune and Bangalore, you can attend Saturday, Sunday classes. Or if you are not in these cities, you can do online course. You can download this white paper which we publish this February along with KPMG. This white paper you can search on internet. You can just take a snapshot or note it down, Reimagining India in the Context of Cybersecurity Threats. This is a white paper Aegis School of Cybersecurity and KPMG jointly published. You can just Google it. This is a fantastic piece of information. You will get to know everything what I was talking about, the cyber security, right? I highly recommend that you should go through this program. Raju, you have done CCNA, wonderful. I think you should apply and hopefully we should really entertain you for this program. Abhinav, Ritin will be speaking about the fees and how you can really apply in this program once I finish. Right, so you can get in touch with Noble, Yashashri and Ritin. Here are their numbers. You guys can really take a snapshot, speak to these guys. They will help you in admission into this program. You guys have any question for me? I can help you. What is the fees, Ritin? 3.5. So Abhinav, the fees of this program is 3.5 lakh rupees for full time, and for part time? 2.5 lakh rupees for the part time. Full time is a 3.5 lakh rupees, and for weekend is a 2.5 lakh rupees. You can pay an installment and you don't have to really worry about the funding. Once you have the admission, you guys will get the bank loan within a week's time. We Aegis also have a lot of financial aids. Those who have good academic records in their 10th, 12th and their undergrad degree, believe me, Aegis is committed to really support you, will not let you lose face. We will not allow, will not let you financial constraints become a hindrance for joining this program. We are committed to support you financially. So don't worry about the finances. You guys, if you are really keen in this program, keen in this field, which is very exciting field, you should apply. We will be having interviews on 2nd June in Mumbai, 9th June in Delhi, and 16th June in Bangalore, and 23rd June in Kolkata. So you can pick up the locations and you can apply and get in touch with our team, Ritin, Yashashri and Noble, Apeksha, Donna. These guys will certainly hold your hand and guide you how to apply in this program. Thank you guys, thank you so much. We had such a wonderful day. I really appreciate your patience and energy that you heard us for almost 3.5 hours. You made my day, made my evening, right? I really love talking to you guys, and hopefully someday we'll meet one-on-one with us, with each other, right? Now I hand over Ritin. Ritin will walk you in next 10 minutes how you can really apply. Thank you guys, thank you so much. Have a good luck for your future.
Okay, a very good evening again to all the individuals who are still live here. And so this is the program. The already we have given you a kind of entire 360 degree view about the cyber security. I'll be quickly walk you through or quickly give you an idea that how you can go ahead, how you can apply. And I can also try to answer your queries. Is it not working, Adit? Adit? It's gone or what? Okay, so you can ask me any questions if you have, though I'll try to answer all of your questions and the queries what you have got. Okay, brilliant. So now this is the program what we have talked about. So these are the associations we have already covered. Aegis and IBM, we have, in collaboration with IBM, we have set up the Aegis IBM cybersecurity lab, which is a virtual lab what we have got, which participants, the physical lab we have, which participants, they use it for doing their in-class projects, consulting assignments, and the real-life projects what we have talked about. Okay. So duration and the delivery models we have already talked about. Like, we have got the full-time program and the executive model as well. Executive model, in terms of the there are two modes of delivery under that executive model. One, which is a classroom training model on Saturday and Sunday, where we have our campuses like Mumbai, Pune and Bangalore. And other one, which will be executive live interactive online program, which will be on Saturday, Sunday, but the mode of delivery would be live interactive. Okay, certification we have already talked about. Curriculum we have already walked you through with it. So these are some of the center of innovation, which participants, to whomever have joined the program, they will get the entire exposure of the industries with the platforms what we have curated, like the Data Science Congress. You can go and check over internet, you will get more idea. This is one of the Asia's largest event we host in the disruptive technologies what we have talked about. Aegis Gramble Award what we have got, participants, they will get the entire exposure on over the new technologies which are coming up. This Aegis Gramble Award, again, it's Asia's or the largest event we host. Another hackathons, workshops, and big data and the cyber security day, these are the hackathons, workshops we keep conducting. Like today we are conducting one meetup. There are so many paid meetups as well what we do conduct on pan India basis. If you guys are here, do subscribe to our channel YouTube, subscribers, our page, get in touch with us. So we will keep updating you with all these meetups on the cities we come up with, like the People's Analytics Conference, the Cybersecurity Conference, a whole lot of things we do in those disruptive areas, which will help you to understand in depth, or maybe kind of overview you will get with those workshops. So keep in touch with us. Career Management Center. So the duration of the program is 11 months, as you all are aware about. So after completion of the program, somebody would have asked that whether there's a placements or not, what we do provide. Like Abhinav had asked, do we have placements in cybersecurity? Certainly, yes. So for that, we have a dedicated career management center who facilitates the participants with excellent internship and placements, what we do provide. Financial aid, if you guys think that you come on any of the bracket, if you feel like if you have got 90, 85 the credentials what you have got. So for the matriculation student, we have this matrix. If you feel that you are fit in any of the matrix and in the column, like you have 90, 90, 85, 85, 85, 80, this is all available on the website itself. Check yourself if you think that okay, that you have these credentials. So certainly there is a fee waiver, like 10%, 20, 30, 50 and 100% waiver what we do provide to the participants over the total tuition fees. And also the bank loans what we have mentioned. So we do have the tie up with various financial institutions who disburse the education loan to the participants. How to apply? If you are looking forward to it, applications are open. And interviews we have already talked about. In the previous session, the process to get enrolled, you have to fill the application. Once you receive the application, an interview would be scheduled. Once the interview get done, in case an interviews we are conducting, again I'm repeating, on 2nd we are conducting the interviews in Mumbai, June, 9th we are going to Delhi, 9th June, and then 16th we are going to Bangalore, we are conducting the interviews, and 23rd we are in Kolkata. So if you fill the application, we'll schedule an interview, and in case you get through and shortlisted on the very same day on the spot, we will get you the admission offer. Now the admission process, again it's a part of it, maybe you can log into aegis.edu.in, muniversity.mobi/aegis, anywhere you can go and check if you will land it up on these websites. Click on the program page, that kind of page you will see that will appear on your screen, and you have to click on the apply button and you can apply. This is how you have to apply, and this is how the page will ask you to log in, which you can log in by using your Google, Facebook or LinkedIn credentials. Any questions so far? Also, one thing we have skipped, like how, because see, you can take a snapshot of my credentials. I'm Ritin Joshi. Can you please turn on that application, presentation, the main one, data science one? Yeah. So I'll just walk them through with it, with all, maybe give them a demo with the how they can access the entire LMS what we have got. Because see, the kind of session what we are doing since this afternoon, so you have been exposed to all those disruptive technologies, starting from your data science, AI, machine learning and cyber security. So it's a kind of aerial view, or maybe a kind of 360 degree view, or a kind of 5000 feet view we have given to you guys. So but if you get completely into the program, so it is a very intensive, very very complex process. Give me a moment. Just a minute, guys, let me take my phone. I'll show you that how you can access these sessions. Okay, so one session is not enough. So if you are learning all those disruptive technologies like machine learning, AI, deep learning, so one session is not enough. So can you please connect my phone, Aditya? I just want to show them a demo. So we have got the learning management system. I'll show you how this. Okay, let me connect my phone. Yeah. 652. Okay, it's done. Okay, it is coming on the screen, right? Okay, can you please go to the slide, please? Presentation? Yes. Okay. So let me quickly take you through to the LMS what we have got. Yes, could you please help me go to the LMS part? Okay, go up. Please go to the come previous slide, yes. Okay, so few proud alumni we have got, so you get the entire details, previous one. So some of the individuals, so if you feel that okay, some of them you have asked that you are from different backgrounds altogether, from commerce background, economics background, because we have been doing the session on data science, AI, and cybersecurity since this afternoon. Some of you have discussed and asked that question. You are from a different background, like from mechanical, from commerce background, how you can do the transition. Some of them you have asked that you have a career break as well. You have 5 years of break. So how you can go ahead? These are some of the rock star in every meetup. What we proudly showcase their profile and the kind of journey what they had with Aegis. Like in the same go, we have Puneet Rathaw. So he joined the program, he has got 3 years of experience. So he has done his BTEC from Rajasthan Institute of Technology, and currently he is working with Morgan Stanley as a director, heading the entire data science vertical. Pratesh, we have Michelle, she is working with Nielsen. She comes from the electronics and communication background. In the same go, like Pratesh Tiwari, he's a fresher, comes from the computer science background, currently AI lead working with PNB. Abhishek Gupta, as you can see, the third guy. So Vigneshwar, he is working with ENY as a data scientist. He's a fresher, comes from electronics and communication background. Saurabh Bidwai, he's working as a data scientist. He was again a fresher, comes from IT stream. Though Abhishek Gupta in the same go, he is working as a data scientist. He's leading the entire data science vertical with Farm Easy. He hails from that computer science, he hails from the BCom background, the commerce background he is coming from. Okay, so now these are the sum of, so you will get the entire details on internet. Okay, so this is the LMS what I was discussing. So these are some of the profiles of the participants. The background we have already discussed, coming from different backgrounds altogether, like from management background, commerce background, economics background, IT background, different backgrounds participants are coming. Okay, yeah, so this is the learning management system what we have got. So as we have talked about, so one session I was giving you an exposure on that. So one session is not enough. Today you might have got some idea about what is data science, what is cybersecurity, how these fields are growing, what are the opportunities in that area. So but suppose if you have joined the program, if you are getting a deeper dive into deep learning or machine learning, it's a very complex subject. So one session is not enough. You have to revive that session. How you will do that? So we have a state of the art learning management system what we have got. As the name suggests, easy to fly, easy to access on the fly, on the go. So how this will work, can you please turn my phone on? I'll give you the kind of demo. So this is the application we have got. You can download that Ambani campus, which is a learning management system we have. This is how the Ambani campus looks like. As you can see on the screen, that might be coming on your screen, this side I believe. Okay, so these are the courses what I have registered myself for. This is the dashboard looks like, and you can see the courses you have registered for. You can explore the new courses, you can attend the live sessions here. It will show you the placements, everything you will get to know. Suppose I'm going to check or maybe revive any session what I have already done, I have already taken. I'm going to the my course setup. This is how the dashboard, the page will come up like. This is how the UI looks like. Suppose I am just going for that any program. Suppose for an example deep learning program, you will see the overall content, the overview, and the instructors as well, like Dr. Akshish Tendulkar. Content wise, all the sessions what we deliver, we record and upload it to the learning management system what we have got. So you can download that session, watch this online, you can take the entire session on your pocket. So this is how the if you play the video, this is how the content will play and look like.
Instructor for deep learning with TensorFlow course.
So all these smart technologies what we use. So there shouldn't be any problem. That you won't face any problem if the faculty is there writing over the board. You will have the same access. Suppose you go for that statistics and probability program, the course what we have. The content part, if I'll show you. So that will be taken care by Dr. Vinay Kulkarni. He hails from IIT Bombay. Both dual degrees he has got from IIT Bombay, PhD from IIT Bombay, and he's a director of Aegis, takes care of the Spark, the statistics part at Aegis. So this is how, if the faculty is there writing something on the board, you will see the entire access on your screen as you can see here. So you can easily recall any sessions, take these sessions on the fly, on the go, take the entire session on your pocket. So just play along with it, that LMS, so that you can get some information on that. Okay. So this is how the system works like the LMS what we have got. Can you please take me to the presentation, please? Okay. So this is all what I want to discuss with you and show you guys so that you have some more clarity about how to digest that intensive program, the curriculum what we have got. We have already given you the exposure on that. So jot down my coordinates. I believe I have already discussed. This is how to apply, how to go ahead. If you have any questions, I can see there are participants who are watching us still. So Adarsh has discussed salary packages for data science as an experienced professional. Okay, so as I have mentioned with you guys, let me take you to the that page itself, the placement part. Can you please go to the placement? It will, yes. The placement one. Yeah. Previous slide. So this is a quick snapshot. So these are the one of the major recruiters who most always they do come and they recruit from us. And these are the companies where our participants they are working. I'll name some of the companies, be it IBM, since we offer this program with IBM, Nielsen, Deloitte, PwC, Mercedes and Ford, they have also picked up the whole lot of candidates. L&T Finance, they have also picked up the candidates. EY, Ernst & Young, Fractal, you might have heard about that organization. So like somebody would have asked me that how much for experience, yeah, I'm coming to that part. And I believe they have, you might have got the answer as well. So this is the statistics what we have got. So the individuals who have typically who are fresher, so companies they have given them a hike of the minimum package for the freshers they have got, that is 6.5 lakhs and maximum freshers they have got 13 lakhs. And individuals typically who have got say 7 to 8 years of experience, companies they have given them a hike of 50 to 100%, and the maximum hike what they have got is around the experienced candidate 300% hike they have got, and maximum packages typically that up to 40 to 48 lakhs we have given. We have already shared, Adarsh, the links with you so that you can go check, you get to know more information on that. So anybody would have any questions? I would love to answer your questions if somebody would have. All right, it seems like we are done. Okay, so again, a very thanks to you guys for attending that session. It was indeed a pleasure talking to you. And we'll be keep conducting such more informative sessions in the future. Do connect with us, subscribe us on YouTube, our channel, because we go live over most of the events. Do keep in touch with us because we keep coming with certain events, hackathons, workshops on pan-India basis. Certainly you will get the benefit from those events what we are coming up. All the very best. Thank you so much. Pleasure talking and connecting with you guys. Thank you.